Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. And I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent. And I'd like to let you know that Fulton MacGregor MSP is joining us online today. And the first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 3 and 4 in private. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
They're all agreed. Thanks. The next item on our agenda is to take evidence as part of our pre-budget scrutiny for 2025 to 2026 from two panels of witnesses. And we're joined on our first panel by Jo Armstrong, who's the Chair of the Accounts Commission, Blythe Deans, who's the Audit Director at Audit Scotland, Lucy Jones, who's the Audit Manager at Audit Scotland, and Derek Ewell, who's a member of the Accounts Commission. And I welcome the witnesses to the meeting, and I would like to invite Jo to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener. And yes, I have a short, brief statement, and I'm using my phone, but it's not switched on. I'm pleased to be here this morning with my colleagues to talk about our insights into the financial challenges facing the sector. As I've shared with you previously, the impacts of the increased strain on council budgets due to growing demands, pay and other inflationary pressures, combined with workforce capacity issues, are beginning to have a direct effect on the delivery of services. Our audit work over the past year has continued to show the significant financial sustainability challenges councils are facing, placing vital public services at risk. To ensure financial sustainability and protect services, not just now but also in the future, transformation, we believe, on a scale we've not seen before, must be encouraged and enabled across the whole system of public service, not just local government. Without this, communities will suffer. We recognise that councils have been transforming how they operate and deliver services for many years, and as said in our recent joint report with the Auditor General for Scotland on digital exclusion, digital technology is a key part of much of that public sector reform. But this change that we're seeking to have happen must happen at the same time as increasing pressures on staff, services and financial resources, and at the same time, keep delivering everyday services, often for the most vulnerable in our communities. Such is the importance of service transformation in local government, and indeed across other parts of public sector. Our report out next week focuses on the work being undertaken by Solus and the Improvement Service to instigate a sector-led transformation programme. To achieve this, collaboration with the Scottish Government is essential and is working with councils, community planning partners and the third sector. As councils transform, they must engage with local communities, ensuring the service that they are delivering is person-centred, a commitment made both by the Scottish and local government in the Verity House Agreement. We in the Accounts Commission will continue to report on local government finances in early 2025 with a range of products that highlight the situation across Scotland as a whole and at individual council level through annual audits and best value reports. This is at the heart of what we in the Commission is about, holding to account, but also supporting and encouraging improvement where we see it and finances are tight. As always, I and my colleagues look forward to answering your questions this morning. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And we are going to turn to questions, and we'll try to direct our... I think, actually, we'll direct our questions potentially to you initially, Jo, and then you can... and bring in anybody. But if you do want to speak, once we kind of bring our questions up, please indicate to the clerks. There's no need for you to turn your microphones on and off. We'll do that for you. And we've got about 90 minutes for this discussion. So I've got a bit of a big picture question in a way. But Jo, you mentioned in your opening statement that local authorities, councils must engage with local communities. And I'd be interested to hear from you how could the forthcoming budget process and local government settlement do more to empower local democracy and ensure that communities get the services they need?
Interesting. To foster local democracy as opposed to deliver the services they need, they may not be the same. So I think it's important that if that is the desired outcome, that there's clear signals that that's what's expected. Our experience to date of speaking with communities and encouraging communities to assist local government or local authorities identify what services are required not surprisingly, is increasingly the case given budget constraints and a need to prioritise. So I think as budgets do get tighter, chief execs and council leaders are now turning more and more to their communities to ask or to signal what is it that they think is critical in their areas. I'm going to turn to Lucy or Bly to give any specific examples you might have to be able to indicate that the communities, the local authorities are continuing or increasingly speaking to the communities about how to prioritise their expenditures.
Yeah, happy to come in, Jo, thanks. So as part of our recent local government budgets briefing, we assessed the level to which councils themselves were engaging with their communities as part of the local budget setting process. And for the most part, councils were engaging with communities, but I think the overall conclusion was that more could be done in that space, and I think it ties in exactly with what Joe said there in terms of that overall understanding of what's important and how the budget process itself can support that, that kind of local democracy and essentially give people what they need. As you might expect, there's a range of approaches to community engagement that councils undertake, all of which have merit, I would say, but there's not that degree of consistency that we'd maybe expect to see in terms of the methodology, the frequency, and ultimately how that then shapes what the budget looks like. So it's certainly an area that will continue to be under review as part of our work. And as I say, the budget briefing that we published in May was a sort of starter into looking at that.
Bly, have you seen any innovation, as a word that comes to my mind, around how local authorities are engaging with communities? Because I hear quite often, and I think in the committee we hear the whole thing about consultation fatigue. And so have you come across any councils that are engaging with communities in a different way that kind of is more uplifting maybe of an experience than this kind of constantly being the I think that what's happened with consultation is that people feel they're consulted, but then they're not seeing a result.
Uplifting is maybe hard to focus on specifically, but no, there's certainly examples from across the different councils that would lend themselves to that type of summary, I guess. There's approaches in place across councils where they will target communication towards what you might consider to be seldom heard groups. So again, given that space and voice that perhaps that particular community group hasn't had in the past, there'll also be the use of digital to facilitate that kind of more widespread community engagement through online survey tools. And again, the merits of those have not been something that we've considered in detail as part of the work, but I think it is important to highlight that councils' approaches vary, and we'll probably see that quite often today. But in this space, it's definitely something that, as I've said, the Commission are keen to focus on, particularly in the face of the scenario that some councils found themselves in last year with regards to public opposition. So when difficult decisions have to be made, it stands to reason that there needs to be robust, meaningful, consistent engagement in advance of that, to avoid the scenario which unfolded in certain councils where the public just weren't happy. The options that were put forward were so unpalatable that they were protested against, and councils then had to reverse decisions, which ultimately impacts on the budget setting process and the services that are then provided to the communities. So it's something that we'll continue to look at as part of our financial work going forward.
Do you see any councils moving towards kind of the full-featured, what's it called, participatory budgeting?
We've seen some examples
of that. I think what, not nice to use the word opportunity, but given financial constraints and the need to prioritise, there's now a time, a need, a desire to explain to communities, whatever your local community might be, what the bigger picture is. Because I think if people can understand the bigger picture, they can begin to understand how their individual requirement fits in. It may not be what they want to hear, because it means that perhaps that facility or that service may be no longer a priority. But I think until we've got proper communication about what the bigger picture looks like and an honesty about what's possible, then abilities to win hearts and minds at the local level will be harder. And the challenge they've got, most local authorities have, is the fact that they don't have, they would argue, a long-term sight on what their budgets are going to be. And so it's very difficult to then know how do we paint the picture of what the long-term vision for our services is going to be. We might argue that that's not an acceptable answer, but I can see that might be one of the ways forward, and saying we continue to just live year by year because we don't know any more than that. I'm not sure that that's an acceptable answer.
Yeah. Okay, thanks for that. I'm going to shift a little bit, but picking up on what you've just said there around the kind of long-term piece there. So, as you know, financial sustainability of local government is one of the main themes for our pre-budget scrutiny. And I think we'd be interested to hear how sustainable you think the finances of our councils are, and should we be worried that what's happened to some local authorities in England could also happen in Scotland?
I think it'd be fair to say that at the moment we're not seeing, the auditors are not telling us anything that would suggest there's an imminent crisis. And the challenges that are being faced down south are not the same challenges up here, because we don't have, well, we've always had an audited process, we've always had strong scrutiny over the sector, unlike in England and Wales. But we've also not had the same financial engineering going on up here as went down, which happened down in down south. So the challenges are different, but the pressures are the same. The demand is rising, cost pressures are rising, and so there is a kind of a financial, as you quite rightly say, financial sustainability challenge. What we're seeing, what we're seeing is that if there's a financial strain, then the acceptable, the availability of services or the ability to receive services will probably end up being reduced through eligibility criteria. So whilst we're not currently seeing financial crises or impending financial implosion, we are seeing the potential for demand to be not met, and that isn't acceptable either. So the opportunity to be more radical, or the need to be more radical in how services are provided, is why we're seeing transformation of the like that's required has not been seen before. And that is about a joined up approach to how we make sure that the services that are wanted and needed are delivered as efficiently, as effectively as possible, mindful of local democracy and mindful of local differences. But there are some elements which are pan-Scotland, probably. There are some areas that are clearly local and need to be looked at as local. So person-centred service delivery is key. But all the background, all the infrastructure, all the kind of non-front-facing type service delivery site type things, there's a question mark as to whether that does all need to be done at the local level. Because if we have to make more out of less, we need to be as efficient and effective as possible.
So you're thinking there, like, all the kind of administrative backbone type stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I don't like to kind of describe back office as something that could be done pan-Scotland, but there is a question mark around the capabilities and capacities of some authorities to be able to deliver the IT services necessary that will be ubiquitous and easy to use and meet all the cyber security type activities. Is that something that can be done across Scotland, or could we piggyback off something that's already there that the Scottish Government's got? I think that's why it's about a joined up approach. It's not just a local government challenge.
Yeah, and certainly there's something there in that we've been hearing a lot about the need for data, and data that's joined up across all local authorities in housing, in how houses are built and where people are living in them and all kinds of things. That's just one area that we hear in planning also. So that could be something that could be part of that transformation.
Yeah, I mean, I certainly get the basics in place first of all, which is the kind of what are the services that are truly more efficiently and effectively delivered or available across Scotland. I'm not saying which they are, but there will be some, and which are truly local, and then help understand how does the local map into the national. But to be building 32 IT systems and maintaining them, to be building 32++, which is already what the Scottish Government's got and all the local public bodies have got, doesn't seem to make a lot of sense. I'm not technical, but efficiencies and effectiveness of that do seem to be certainly questionable.
Blythe.
Thanks, Convener. I thought it might just be helpful to come in and just expand a little bit on what Joe said around the assurance process that's in place that the Commission have around local government finances. So the annual audit is a key part of that. So each council will obviously be subject to audit on an annual basis. There's also reporting by the Controller of Audit to the Accounts Commission, and that takes place monthly as well. So anything that is emerging as part of the audit work will be flagged to the Controller of Audit. The Controller of Audit will then bring it to the attention of the Commission. There's also what we would term a current issues process, whereby anything that's emerging from the audits of significance, again, would be brought to the attention of the Commission and action would be taken thereafter. The Controller of Audit and the Commission also have a programme of Section 102 reports covering best value. So again, that gives the Commission a chance to have a bit of a, maybe a deeper dive in a certain area or aspect of best value, which again is a great chance just to highlight any emerging and significant concerns. And there's also a report that the Controller of Audit brings to the Commission on assurance and risks across local government. As part of that, the Commission will then select a thematic area of focus for the next round of best value work. So that current best value work is focusing on workforce innovation, and the next round of work will focus on transformation. So that was a really long way of me linking that back to what Joe's just said there around the need for transformation in terms of supporting financial sustainability.
Derek.
Maybe just to add a couple of things to this, maybe from a different perspective, because you mentioned in your question some of the sort of failures in England, and I think it's important. So some of the research we've done to try and find out what was behind that was round about the governance. So what we're saying about the best value process and look that deeper dive into the governance structures within councils, I think is very important to get the assurance there is a good relationship between members and officers and how that financial advice has been acted on. And we just recently issued a blog about the stressing the importance of the role of the Chief Financial Officer in terms of that, because quite often we are seeing that the role is wider than just finance for many of the Section 95 officers within Scotland, or it's down at head of service level. And one of the assurances we did seek from the auditors was to make sure that the Chief Financial Officer was at the top table, so to speak, of councils, and they had a good working relationship with members as part of that process.
That's very helpful. And both of those contributions, I'm glad that I like that you laid out the process, and things come out of a whole series of work that you've been doing to unearth that. Those areas of focus. Given the forecasted financial environment that we're looking at, how robust do you see the financial plans that are being developed by councils? And obviously, they're probably different for different councils.
Oh, very much so. And again, it reflects the kind of different capabilities and capacities for across the sector. But I think to argue we can only give you a one-year budget because we only get one-year funding, as I said earlier, I don't think that's acceptable. And I think we are signalling, have signalled, and will continue to signal that we would expect to see medium-term financial strategies being developed. They will have assumptions in them, and some of them will be more heroic assumptions than others. But I think to assume no funding in the future, probably unrealistic. To assume the same level of funding in the future, definitely value looking at assumptions around that. But I think there's a need, and we have signalled it in our most recent report, we expect to see medium-term financial strategies developed by all local authorities and probably more importantly, to be developed in a way that's actually understandable by councillors, by communities, and probably, to be honest, with by us, because sometimes they are a bit opaque. So, but the importance of them is critical.
Okay. Thanks very much for that. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey some questions.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to everybody again. Joe, I wonder if I could start with you. This committee often hears extremely different points of view, depending who's sitting in those chairs there, about, particularly about finance and local government. The improvement service benchmarking framework, it seems to present a more positive picture of local government finances, certainly in terms of debt management and reserves, healthy reserves. But then, on the other hand, we hear from our colleagues in COSLA how serious the position actually is. First of all, why is that? Why is there such a divergence in opinion and view for when essentially we're talking about the same thing, local government finance?
Yeah, I wouldn't want to put words in the improvement services' mouth, but I'm not particularly sure that they would say it's healthy. I think some of the data they've got would suggest things are getting worse rather than better in terms of performance. And the reserves issue is a critical one. And to understand the reserves and think a healthy balance sheet reserve is actually a reserve that can be used for funding services day to day, I think it's also misleading. So I think we have also signalled and Blythe and his team are undertaking an analysis of all the reserves that are kicking around, because I think it doesn't help the debate about what's needed if you think on one hand it's everything's going well because you've got large balance sheet reserves, and on the other hand we've got limited reserves, 2% of our net expenditure, and we're facing a need to cut services. So I we take the responsibility of actually trying to unpick what's happening on reserves, because to get that bottomed out will then help foster a debate around what does service level look like and what do we actually need to deliver the services we expect.
Mm-hmm. Life.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Thanks, Mr. Coffey. Yeah, so on the local government benchmarking framework indicators, Joe summarised it well. I mean, the Commission definitely supports that sector-led monitoring of performance, and it is a very helpful tool, especially for us as auditors. I think it is important to say, and if the LGBF board were here, they would say so, it operates almost as a can opener to further analysis. So although that presents a bit of a kind of headline picture, it can hopefully direct towards maybe a bit more detailed review of what those indicators are actually telling us. It's also important to note that the sector are very much aware that the indicators need to be kept under review. And actually, if that type of question is being asked, then that might suggest that there's maybe scope to include some additional indicators in the financial sustainability space. That is a relatively recent development as part of the framework, a helpful one, I think we would say. But there are other indicators that could potentially be included in there that might help tell a bit more of that story. So it's a bit of a watch this space for now. But as I say, I think the Commission would very much support the use of the LGBF in terms of monitoring financial sustainability and resilience.
Yeah, we've mentioned this before, the committee, about reserves, the reserves position. I think we probably have asked yourselves, but we can't seem to agree what the indicators are. I mean, we've got categories like contingency funds, earmarked, un-earmarked, committed, not committed. There's a whole myriad of terms that frankly we struggle to understand, just where all the various bits of money that local authorities still have are tucked away into, and what they're to be used for. Will we get a clearer picture of that? I've probably asked you this before, Joe. Do you think
we certainly want to unpick
set of criteria for this stuff?
We certainly want to unpick that, Mr. Coffey, and it is one that prudent financial management, I would argue, suggests that you want to put monies away here, there, and everywhere to be able to cope with the pressures you know are likely to be coming. And there are also unknown pressures that you have to be able to finance. So having reserves is a good thing. Having a reserves policy and how they're being used, I think, is really important. And we would want to understand how each local authority is identifying what its reserves policy is and making that clear to the council leaders, council and communities. But having reserves is not a bad thing. It is a good, sound financial management tool. But we are equally bemused by, as you are, about what do all these headlines mean? And trying to unpick that is part of, again, a piece of work that's coming out. When, Blythe?
So that'll be January time for the next local government financial bulletin. I'm conscious I've sat in front of this committee and probably offered similar answers in this space, so I'll try my best not to repeat what I've said in the past, but Joe's touched on it there. What we're really keen to see is a bit more clarity, a bit more transparency, particularly around purpose and timing. So there's certain sets of accounts that are pretty clear, I would say, in terms of the purpose of each reserve, lots of detail in there, and others that are very much at a headline level, which makes it quite difficult, as you've quite correctly pointed out, to determine what that's actually for. There's also something around the timing. What's appropriate in terms of holding a reserve? What kind of horizon are we talking about here? I mean, even just a kind of broad sense of, is it over 3 to 5 years? Is it going to be spent within the next 12 months? Again, that would help just in terms of understanding the relationship between reserves and overall financial sustainability. Reserves policy and strategy is a big focus of the work that we're carrying out at the moment. I think what we're really keen to do is look at that in a bit more detail, understand more about the status and profile of that document across the council, how well cited the public are on those documents, frequency of review, how it links in with the medium-term financial strategy. You can probably tell there's a lot going on just now that we can report back to the committee on after that report in January is published. But again, it is an area that we're keen to see further work and the transparency improved ultimately.
Mm-hmm. Would you see yourselves making a particular recommendation about some kind of consistent, standardised way of describing this issue and asking the government perhaps to to formalise that so that we don't continue to get a varying and different picture depending on what council we talk to. Do you see that being a useful tool?
I dare to step into the role of being a regulator dictating rather than an auditor auditing, and I'd rather be in the latter than in the former. If the committee was to ask for something that would help, we would certainly look and help to support if that was something you were wanting. But we're not regulators, we're auditors. What we have signalled is this kind of a desire to have a certain clarity around what revenues are you receiving, what are your expenditures, what's the gap before you actually then have to use the reserve, and then how are you using reserves. We will, through our analysis, come up with a kind of an understanding of how clear or otherwise that reserves picture looks like, and it may end up becoming some sort of recommendation, but not a dictated requirement, I wouldn't have thought.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Just my other question to you was just on capital funding. Have the councils got any other mechanisms open to them for capital funding other than capital grants and borrowing and so forth? Is there any other measures that they may be able to deploy locally to deliver?
You can answer that, Derek. Thanks.
You've mentioned the two main two, right. But sale of assets, capital receipts is another area that councils can use, or they can use an element of the revenue budget to finance capital expenditure. And that has probably been more common in the housing environment in the past than within the general fund, but it is a mechanism that's available to councils.
Are many of them deploying that, do you know?
Couldn't honestly tell your position at the moment. I think it's less common, and I think typically the level of capital receipts has probably dropped off over the years. It's a much smaller proportion. I think did we do any analysis on the capital funding?
Yeah, we did. So capital expenditure, I don't actually have the figures in front of me, but from memory, Derek's right in terms of the proportion the capital receipts makes up in terms of the overall expenditure is pretty small. I think it was round about, well, it was less than a billion of over $3.5 billion spent. It varies across the country, obviously, depending on what the asset base looks like and what they can and can't actually sell. And as Derek says as well, the sort of capital funding from current revenue feels like it's not going to be happening that often, just in the sense that actually capital has been used to fund revenue pressures at the moment, so actually that feels like a bit of a kind of shift in position. So I would anticipate that our financial bulletin in January will again set out the sources of capital finance and hopefully be able to draw some conclusions on that.
Lucy?
I've got the percentages if you'd like them. So for internal revenue funding, it's 7%. That was what it was for 24-25, and then capital receipts is down at 4%. So there really are quite minor contributions.
Okay, thanks very much for that. I look forward to this January review and update. It will clear up all these issues for us. Many thanks for your answers to those questions, Karina.
Thanks very much. Just, before we move on the indicators piece, Blythe, you said that there might need to be new indicators. Should we wait till your report in January for that response?
Possibly. I'm not sure it's for me to sit here and direct the local government benchmarking framework towards which specific indicators should be used, but there's certainly elements of our reports that might lend themselves quite nicely towards an indicator that could help in terms of assessing financial sustainability. I can offer a few thoughts just now, certainly, as I say, not to direct the benchmarking framework board, but savings would be a big part of that in terms of the relationship between recurring and non-recurring. I think that would be a helpful barometer in terms of which councils are generating the savings that are going to be contributing to financial sustainability and which of those are making savings that are actually a bit of a plaster over a wound. There's also something about use of reserves in there. I think the indicator at the moment is helpful in terms of that percentage of the net revenue spend, but again, there's analysis within our reports that shows which councils are actually having to use reserves to balance budgets. So again, that might give a sense of trend in terms of a council that's actually getting close to, not depleting reserves, but getting on that trend towards financial difficulty. I think that's probably enough for me to say just now, but certainly it's something that we know that the sector are taking forward and are keen to enhance the effectiveness and helpfulness, I guess, of that suite of indicators.
Okay, thanks very much for that detail. going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us. I wanted to touch upon the Verity House Agreement and just in your opinion, what you think, your understanding anyway, is of developments towards that fiscal framework which was put forward and also monitoring and accountability framework which was included in the agreement.
I mean, to be fair to say, we have not yet received anything. I believe there are things going on in discussions. We've taken the view that we do not wish to be part of that development phase, because if we've got to be, if we've got to be monitoring and giving assurance, then we've got to be not marking our own homework. But we look forward to receiving it. We certainly think it's an important part of how we get comfortable with the transformation of change that's going to be required, is that joined up approach around what financing and expectations in terms of outcomes are, but haven't seen anything as yet. Encourage them to go go faster.
When would you expect to have that shared?
I've got no indications yet. Has anybody else got any indications yet? No, have no indications at the moment, Mr. Briggs.
No, thanks for that. And in terms of some of the conversations we've had over the years around reforms and commissions, specifically looking at the aims around the Christie Commission back in 2011. Do you think that's actually helped in the work you've done to move towards preventative spend and reform of public services? And I think to loop back to Verity House Agreement, is that going to help update that in your sense to try to take forward that work?
Again, I will turn to my colleagues in a minute, but I think it'd be fair to say the movement towards preventative spend has not been as fast or as far as I think people thought was possible, and certainly Christie suggested was needed. In fact, some of the cuts we're seeing are some of the ways of managing budget challenges is actually potentially diminishing further movement towards preventative spend. That's where the transformation that we're looking for has got to be much more significant than is currently the case. It's not just salami slicing efficiency savings. It's now taking a step back and saying, what is it we want to deliver and how can we reduce the demand side to some extent, which is through increasing the use of preventative measures, rather than just dealing with the inevitable rise in demand given the demographics in the country. And that's where I would hope the Verity House Agreement, the discussions around what outcomes are expected, would be part and parcel of that process. Does anybody have any other comments they want to make?
Yeah, thanks, Joe. I can just add to that very briefly, Mr. Briggs, on the point about the shift to preventative spend. We've reported in the past and spoken to this committee about the protected versus unprotected services element, and when it comes to the funding, a lot of the preventative measures would fall within those unprotected services, hence the cuts to those services have made that more difficult. So that feels like an important part of that story as well. It's again something that the Commission have reported on in the past.
Thank you for that. And I know in the submission, the Commission's submission, you state that councils urgently need to transform how they deliver services to become financially sustainable. And you've touched upon some of the potential around a Once for Scotland approach around IT. And I think NHS Scotland, for example, have kind of been moving towards that. And around procurement as well, opportunities for savings and efficiencies around that. But can I ask what you would like to see included in the forthcoming budget to try to take that work forward and to actually look towards how councils can collectively maybe work together to become more financially sustainable going forward, especially when you look at some of the work, my own council, for example, in the sort of city regions sort of areas, there's a potential, I think, there to take forward collective sharing of resources, of expertise, especially in planning and things like that.
I mean, I think it's an opportunity and it's a real pressure. And there is a fear, a potential of failure, which stops activity happening. And I think we're potentially at that stage of not quite sure willing to be taking something forward that might be more different to what's normal, what's expected. And if it doesn't quite work out, who's then going to be accused of not doing their job properly or being poorly briefed, or failure is a bad thing in the public sector. I would like I think the budget, my colleagues can chip in if they feel there's additional things, but I think the ring fencing doesn't help, because it does mean that there's an expectation of outcomes that may not be totally relevant for each local authority. And I'm not saying which services, but I think having some sort of level of ability to switch and veer funding where outcomes as specified by communities, so it's about communication, might be a better route to delivering more efficiency and more effectively. So the incentive system for me works. So if the budget was to be able to say, if you increase your communications, if you identify what's needed, and if you can convince us that the effective approach you're choosing to do is as efficiently as effective as possible, potentially more money might come. Again, the budget cycle is really, really, really challenging, as we all know. So there's not a lot of extra around, but how do you incentivise leaders to take risks, to do something more radical than would otherwise be the case? I think it's important for me to think about how we support that leadership in as best we can. But the transformation won't happen quickly. That's the other side, is actually financial sustainability isn't going to be supported by quick transformation. It's got to be long-term transformation. So we're in between the times of actually doing the difficult thing and being more innovative. They've also got to keep just delivering services. So having an honest debate, communication with your service users, with your communities, and understanding where priorities are going to have to be made, I think that would be, again, be incentivised to do that. Because otherwise, we're going to face a salami slice approach, which just reduces service rather than increasing the opportunity to do more. And I think the city-region works, but it's clearly not relevant for all parts of the country. But I do think there's a need to be absolutely honest about, can we do everything at the geographical level? We've got a local authority responsibility, because some things are not just local government. It's across the public service, and it is connecting up with communities. It is connecting up with third sector in a way that potentially might be seen as an anathema to some. But if we're wanting to make sure the outcomes for users are as good as possible, we actually need to be that radical.
Anything else to add?
Derek? Maybe a couple of thoughts from me. I mean, Joe mentioned ring fencing. There's a bit in there about directed spend as well, and the role of councils in terms of local decision making, and that links into the communities. The other thing I would say, and it's been mentioned before, is about a multi-year funding set to give councils some degree of certainty of funding for me. And it's not just councils. We talk about different delivery models. So for the third sector, for example, who often receive their funding from councils, one of the biggest barriers, I think, they have to planning, delivering services is that unknown factor over a number of years. And possibly the other thing would be actually some funding for preventative measures. It's not just about money, because I think some of it's about behaviours and transformation, how different parts of the public sector or the public sector and the third sector, private sector work together and come up with transformational ways of working. So that isn't necessarily about money, but I think there probably are some areas where some directed funding for preventative measures would perhaps give that incentive to avoid some of the things that Joe's talking about in terms of the difficulty in maintaining what you do currently with funding. Where does the money come from for transformations? Part of that.
If I may just add to that, Mr. Briggs, so the point or the question you'd asked around that sort of Once for Scotland approach, the sector are very much in that space at the moment through the Solace and Improvement Service Transformation Programme. So that's one of the kind of key elements of some of the short-term projects in terms of more effective collaboration, particularly around procurement. But there's also some examples that we have found from audit work and engagement with the sector around relatively small scale examples of sharing services. For example, internal audit is shared across Glasgow and Shetland and Dundee and Angus. And from what we hear, it's working well. So albeit small scale, there's still principles and fundamentals there that could be scaled up to perhaps get to that sort of scenario that you painted there, particularly around control, governance, impact. I think there's a lot to learn there. So I think that there's definitely some activity within the sector that will help get to that point at some point in the near future.
Thanks for that. And on that point, have you done any work previously to map where councils have maybe looked to change services to put, for example, bin services out to tender and efficiencies that's delivered for councils and other councils which potentially have taken a political decision not to do that, and where we're seeing different services then being delivered in different ways in all 32 councils at different costs.
Okay, Blythe, you want to pick up?
Yeah, we've not done that, but I mentioned kind of earlier on in the meeting the focus of the next year's local best value work will be on transformation. So as part of that, we're looking to draw examples of exactly what you've described there in terms of activity, exercises, steps that councils have taken to transform and ultimately be in a position, or the Commission be in a position, to share those examples across the rest of the country to promote the learning and hopefully, as you say, can improve the efficiency of that approach. So while there's potentially been some examples from previous best value reports, I think I would focus on the work that's going to be kicking off next month and will be reported thereafter.
That's great. Thank you. Thanks, Matt.
Thanks, Miles. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosell.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Every year you see local government and central government scrabble to find enough money to meet the pay demands of local government workforce. Given employment costs are around 70% of the local authority revenue budgets, how can pay deals be managed more sustainably and strategically?
Goodness, again, I'm not feeling I've got a competence to argue about how to be better at negotiating pay deals, to be honest with you, Ms. Gosell, but I imagine the current process, if it's not proving adequate, there's plenty of people out there would argue how to make it better, but it requires a joined-up approach, and I believe the current process is at least joined up and has all the key players probably always in the room at the same time. It's critical. But I think the issue for us is about the honest discussion with communities about what services are needed, what's the cost of those services, and therefore what's possible and what's deliverable, and then a debate about what priorities need to be had. And if that has an effect on what the pay bargaining arrangement looks like, then that's where it should start from rather than necessarily the other way around.
Anybody else want to add anything?
No.
I would maybe just add one. Again, it goes back to, I think, multi-year. I mean, as Joe said, the processes are in place of that dialogue and negotiation. I think sometimes we have a public sector pay policy for 1 year at a time can be a challenge. I know, even notwithstanding that, there have been attempts to get multi-year settlements, but again, if you know what the funding is over multi-years, it does help that negotiation.
Thank you. Just a supplementary to that, last week, obviously, we had evidence in this committee in relation to that lower pay for councillors is a barrier to many people, including people from ethnic minorities, but also disabled, but also women as well. And obviously, with budgets are tight, how do they look at balancing the need between high public service and adequate council pay? Do you have any view on that, Joe?
No, again, you're verging into the kind of policy side of things, which I don't have a view on. And I think the communication or the kind of research work and the strategy work that's going on to try and identify how to deal with that must be the route to finding a solution. I've got nothing more to add, I'm afraid, on that.
OK, no, thank you for that. I've got one more question, sorry. Thank you, convener. Does the rise in council debt of £1 billion between 2021 and 2022 and 2022 and 2023 give rise to sustainability concerns when it comes to council finances? And what point does the council borrowing become a problem?
Again, I will look to Blythe or Lucy to kind of give the details, but clearly borrowing is needed for developing assets and infrastructure. So I wouldn't be surprised to see borrowing rising as new projects are being developed. The LEAP project requires government local authorities to borrow to allow them to develop new schools, so not too surprising. To get access to PWLB debt, you need to be able to show you it's affordable and is within the budget capabilities of each local authority. So again, the likelihood of financial challenges around that needs to be taken into account, that PWLB will have done their homework to show whether or not that's an affordable addition to any debt burden. So additional debt does cause problems in the future because it's an ongoing commitment to pay it back. But again, the affordability of that is tested to some extent by PWLB when debt's taken on. Is there anything else you want to add to that?
Yeah, if I can, thanks, Joe. I'll go back to what I mentioned earlier on about that sort of the different layers of assurance that the Commission have. So one of the kind of fundamental building blocks of that would be the annual audit. So if there were to be significant concerns about the debt profile of an individual council, it would be raised as part of that annual audit, which would then obviously catch the attention of the Commission, and then there would be further work thereafter. We're not seeing that at the moment. There's not anything coming through to us that would suggest that the level of debt at a local level is, well, it is challenging, but it's not problematic in the sense that it requires further work. There could be good reason why debt increases in a certain year. For example, looking at City of Edinburgh Council, within 21-22, there was an increase in the level of debt because the interest rates were at a level where it was quite attractive, and the council anticipated that in future years the interest rates wouldn't quite be as attractive, hence borrowing at that point in time saved them having to borrow at a higher rate in the next year. So again, it will all be determined, or not all of it, but most of it will be determined by a local treasury management strategy as well, and the council will be bound by the prudential code. So there's safeguards and boundaries in place that would protect the council in terms of straying out with that limit, and it would keep elected members briefed on kind of where that debt position is standing. So there's various layers of assurance within that. We'll continue to report on it as well within our report in terms of that national position. But as I say, it's not anything that we've had to look at in the level of detail that would suggest that there's a major red flag at this point.
No, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Pam. Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I wonder if the Commission has any examples it can point to of good practice in community engagement in budget decisions.
Lucy, please.
So, yeah, I think I mentioned earlier on, we did look at this as part of the local government budgets 24-25 paper that was published in May. So as part of that, we did capture quite a varied picture in terms of the level of activity, the methodology used. So I do have a list of councils, so I can give you a flavour of kind of what we found across some of those examples. So Clackmannanshire Council engaged well with communities when setting their priorities. There was a four-phase community engagement programme, and Clackmannanshire were committed to 2% of the revenue budget towards participatory budgeting. So that had been brought up earlier on. It is obviously a very small proportion, but having that commitment is obviously a good thing in terms of empowering the community, in terms of directing how that money is spent. Falkirk Council was another one where there was public engagement on key decisions around things like swimming pool closures. So again, that ties back to what I mentioned earlier on about public opposition to something that feels unpalatable if it was to be taken away, for example. The climate we're in, councils are facing these difficult choices, so it's really important that they have those conversations up front. Dumfries and Galloway was the one that I mentioned earlier on where they were targeting communication towards seldom heard groups. So those where it would be not easy to miss them, but that has probably happened in the past just in terms of the accessibility of that information and taking on board the feedback that ultimately affects everyone. So that was, again, something just to highlight. Everything else is much of a muchness. It feels kind of along the same lines. Again, it's something that we'll continue to look at as part of the budget briefing for 25-26, which will come out next year.
So while there were good examples, and we know that 24 councils did consult during the budget process, there were six that didn't at all, which is probably quite worrying. So it's that balance between there are people that are doing this really well, but there are others that aren't even doing it at all. And given the pressures and the need for transformation, it's imperative that those that aren't doing it start doing it, and then the next step would be start doing it well.
In terms of participatory budgeting, obviously it's a way for communities to feel like they've got a stake in council budgeting decisions, but it's not always the majority who are missed when it comes to decisions around where investment is required and where progress on realisation of rights is required. So how should councils engage the community without allowing minority voices to be kind of overshadowed.
And I think it's a valid kind of challenge back to participatory budgeting can be extremely powerful, but you're quite right, it is with those engaged citizens who want to get involved. So again, it's about a long-term communication strategy about what's needed, what's wanted, and how to engage better with those who are not just the engaged few, but the many. And that just takes time. That's not something you can turn a switch on and have happen overnight. The extent to which participatory budgeting gives citizens a taste for something like that is a good thing. The ability to actually make major changes through a participatory budgeting process with a minority group would probably be the wrong thing to be doing, but it's certainly engaging at this stage in that way is a good thing, and it starts to get councils aware of the power of the voice of the community as opposed to the dictating to the communities what's available and what's possible. And I would not want to say that local government dictates, but it's a kind of the alternative be this is what's available rather than what's possible. So it's about opening up and releasing some level of control. If you ask and you don't give, you'll not get them back to your table. So you need to be speaking and listening and then telling them what you've done with it so that at least people feel engaged.
Just finally, if that's okay, Convener, there are really tough decisions having to be made across the public sector, and undoubtedly that means that there will be very worthy causes which are not getting as much money as we would like, or money is having to be moved from something which requires investment if it's going to make change. Is there enough communication of why decisions are being made and for how long the situation is expected to be this way for whatever group or issue it is when councils are having to make those tough decisions?
Again, I'll come back to my colleagues, but I think the fact that you've had some judicial reviews would suggest that the communication hasn't been adequate. The extent to which that judicial review then has fundamentally changed what's happening, I don't know, because ultimately if there's a budget pressure, then something still has to be cut, whether it's the project that didn't get funded first time round or something else. It doesn't matter. The communication is critical. The extent to which it's adequate, I think we're all engaging a little bit differently and we're all beginning to feel the need to understand a bit more. Is there anything you can pick up, Blythe, around the kind of communication strategy as such that would help?
I'm not sure it'll help. We didn't assess the effectiveness of those exercises as part of the work, but I think it's a legitimate question, just in following on from Joe's comments there about how important that is as part of that overall process. We also considered things like the extent to which councils used equality impact assessments as part of the budget setting process, and not all did. So again, that was quite a strong finding from that report. So again, there's definitely an area for us to continue to focus on going forward. But we recognise and have commented on the importance of effective, robust and genuine community engagement as part of the budget setting process.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Just picking up on the participatory budgeting. So Blythe, you mentioned that Clerk Manager gave 2% of his budget to participatory budgeting. But could I ask, is that, so we have that in Murray, we have participatory budgeting, but people are now starting to call it more like participatory grant making, because it's not really getting at the heart of the council's budget. It's more communities choosing to fund good community projects, but it's not really, the original idea of communities engaging in the council budget came from Brazil, I think it was, and they were really getting in there and deciding on the buses and that kind of at that kind of level of decision making. So I just wonder if that's happening with CLACS, or is it still really we're still at the grant making stage, because that's training wheels to get that kind of sense of agency happening in communities.
No. Blythe, you get any more insights into that in CLACS?
I've not, but I'd be happy to write to the committee with a bit further on that. At the moment, it's still quite a kind of headline 2% of budget, and we've not really looked at that in too much more detail, but absolutely recognise the point that you raise around the process and whether it is truly participatory budgeting or if it is, as you say, that kind of more allocation of grant funding. So, yeah, happy to come back to the committee on that one.
Thanks very much for that. And I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. There are six short-term local government transformation projects which the Improvement Service and Solace are working on. Just to ask if you're getting updates on those six projects and if you see any themes developing that could maybe assist councils with bridging some of the budget gaps in the next year to 18 months that the projects are expected to deliver on.
Again, seek Lucy and Blythe to fill in any of the details, but we are not receiving any updates currently. We are conscious that it's an aspiration. We're conscious that there's a number of chief execs fully engaged. I'm not sure it's across the whole sector at this stage. My understanding of it, it's principally being taken forward on the back of the non-day job work. So the extent to which you can do transformation that's truly transformational and will work and be scalable requires resource and dedicated teams to doing that. So we are arguing, we're asking for more detail, both in terms of quantum of change required, budgets to be developed, timelines and targets to be achieved. The extent to which that's possible with the current resource, I would question, but I think the intent is absolutely the right intent. So the extent to which anybody can start to help encourage more more spend and more dedicated resource to doing that, the better.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else?
I was just going to say we have reviewed a number of progress reports that the Transformation Programme produced. The last one, I think, was late spring, early summertime. And at that point, those six projects were progressing quite well through the discovery phase, like the planning stage, and bringing expertise in terms of the different areas that the projects are about. And the aspiration is that during the summer they were going to move on to developing business cases for each of the projects. They are set as 12 to 18 month projects, and they kicked off in January, so that's kind of 10 months in, I suppose, almost. And we would expect to see that progress kind of probably pick up if they're wanting to achieve. I think the idea is that they'll implement within the 12 to 18 months, but obviously the kind of outcomes from it may take longer. And as Joe said, that there already are issues just around that kind of workforce capacity to be able to actually deliver of them. So I think the aspiration is there, but the challenges in terms of delivering and implementing them are quite high.
Okay. Right.
Yeah, I'll come in as well, Mr. Griffin. I don't want to link everything back to reserves, but there are lots of examples of transformation funds or modernisation funds or change funds within council reserves. So as Joe mentioned there, and as Lucy has quite rightly set out, this is still quite early stage, but it would be interesting to see the approach that councils take in terms of utilising some of those balances to support this programme and perhaps accelerate things. So that we do see the progress that we would expect. We've got a report out next week on the sort of current status of that transformation programme led by Solace and the Improvement Service, which we hope will be a useful stepping stone into the local transformation work that we're going to start in October as well. So it's definitely a strong area of focus that we have for the time being.
Okay, thanks for that. The other area I wanted to ask about was on capital funding again, and just to ask your view on whether councils have adequate capital funding just now to maintain and develop community facilities and infrastructure that people expect. But then on further down the line, the capital funding requirements that councils are going to need to hit our expectations around housing and particularly net zero.
Yeah, capital funding is a serious challenge from the point of view of being able to maintain existing assets whilst also developing new assets. I agree with you. That's and if you have to switch capital to revenue, that just adds to the burden of being able to do that effectively. We don't have, or do we have, updated information on the capital plans across the sector as opposed to individual and on each audit?
Not at the moment.
So we don't have a detailed understanding of where the capital requirements are across the sector. It's clearly for each local authority to determine what their capital plans would be and the extent to which that's allocated to new developments as opposed to refurbishment or net zero. That's part of the challenge they're facing, is that they probably don't have enough, but I don't think anybody would have enough given the net zero challenge. And that's not to say net zero challenge is wrong, it's just a really significant capital requirement for that. So that's where the joined up approach is absolutely essential, so that we make sure that we've got effective and efficient processes to develop that. Derek, is there anything you want to pick
up? It's almost pieces of a jigsaw, and there's probably three things I would highlight that councils should have in place as part of this, maybe stepping away from what they should be spending, in a sense that it's the decisions that they need to make. We've spoken about a medium-term financial strategy, so that would set out the revenue funding requirements over probably 3 to 5 years as a minimum. Now, one of the constituent elements of that should be linked to the capital investment strategy that the council has, and its borrowing strategy or funding strategy linked to its treasury management. So the decisions that the council needs to make is how it prioritises capital investment alongside revenue expenditure for the day-to-day provision of services, and that's a value judgment that the council would need to make. The building blocks are in place in terms of various strategies and the flexibilities that councils have in terms of capital, I was almost going to say against revenue, but capital alongside revenue. Those are the choices that they have to make. How they choose to then prioritise their capital investment in terms of the affordability linked to the revenue budget would really be a local decision making. Probably, I suspect they will all argue they don't have enough money, but in terms of the various bits that they have in terms of the system as it currently operates, they should be able to make the sort of choices within what they see to be the affordability that's available to them.
Thank you. Thanks, Sabina.
Thanks, Mark. And just maybe there's nothing for you to add more, but I just wanted to point out that we talk about net zero, but that's about emissions reduction, but we also have situations where many councils are kind of coastal, but actually even not coastal, where we're facing flooding and that kind of thing, which is more a kind of climate adaptation part of the mix that they need to be addressing. Is that something that you look at or have looked at?
I would agree with you that net zero is definitely not just emissions. The flooding is something we are actively looking at. How can we assess the extent to which the flooding challenge is being addressed effectively across the local authorities? The timing for such a report is yet to be determined, but it's part of our strategic intent over the next 12 months is to have something on that specific topic.
Okay, thanks very much for that. I've got another question just coming back on financial sustainability, which I asked earlier, and I've got a note here that some local authority service areas are experiencing significant cost pressures, as we've kind of been discussing all morning, and in particular in adult social care. And I wonder, not to single any out particularly, but do you see a pattern in terms of connection to demographics or something like that?
To be fair, Ms. Burgess, we haven't done a kind of a correlation between the spend and the challenge. And I think to suggest it's directly linked, I think we've got to make sure that every local authority is, or each service provider, and I think it's service provider around local authority, is doing as efficiently and effectively as possible. And I think, again, it's a bit about, is every service that we've got the right service? Is every provider the right provider? And have we got the right efficiencies within each providing service? So that's an easy kind of, not glib, but challenge back. Is it to say we don't have enough? Have we made best use of what we've got at the moment to make sure that we can then say we need more? And I'm not sure we can necessarily see everywhere that we're as efficient and as effective as we should hope they would be.
Well, we've come to the end of our questions, but I just want to, we've got a little bit of time in hand. If there's anything you feel that we haven't, that you were expecting us to ask you about, if there's anything that we haven't touched on, we have a little bit of time. Anything you wanted to add or emphasise?
I think the transformation is not easy. The transformation is going to be significant, and, but it's not going to be quick. So there's two challenges around maintaining solvency stroke service delivery whilst you transform, and is the transformation the right transformation? And the transformation is not just not local government, it is across public services. And having that mindset, I think, needs to be part and parcel of the debate and part and parcel of the challenge back. And I would urge this committee to use your powers to be able to challenge back on public services rather than public sector, because it's public services that ultimately is what communities and individuals want, as opposed to necessarily the public sector getting its house in order. So I think the challenge back to you would be to, can you use this mechanism to challenge those who are actually providing services, that they're doing the right services in the right place at the right time?
Okay, thank you very much for that challenge. We'll look into that. Yeah. So thank you so much for joining us this morning. I think it's been a very useful discussion and yeah, insightful, and certainly that pointer at the end, but also I think some other things have come up that we can take further, and we'll be looking forward to hearing from you after that January report comes out.
Thank you very much.
Yeah,
thank you.
I now briefly suspend the meeting while arrangements are made for our second panel to join us online.
We're joined on our second panel this morning online by Dr. Jonathan Carr-West, who's the Chief Executive at the Local Government Information Unit, otherwise known as LGIU, and Abdul Kara, who's the Executive Director at the National Audit Office. And I welcome the witnesses to our meeting, and I'd like to invite Jonathan and Abdul to begin by making brief opening statements. So start with Jonathan.
Thank you very much, Chair. So at LGIU, we're a membership body that works with councils across the UK, Republic of Ireland and Australia. We have 27 of Scotland's councils in our membership. And our evidence today is going to be drawn from a survey we do every year of asking councils about their financial sustainability and from our experience looking at councils in other jurisdictions. The picture in Scotland, it has to be said, is pretty bleak. When we ran our survey in November last year, and we surveyed chief executives, leaders, and chief finance officers. Of the 42 of them who responded to our survey, only one said that they were quite confident in the sustainability of local government finance. They all cite inflation, central government ring fencing, workforce pressures, and demographic change as the key factors that are driving financial crisis. As you'll have heard and seen in your other submissions, the Accounts Commission estimates a budget gap for Scottish councils of £580 million. So we think this is a critical time to be looking at the financial sustainability of local authorities in Scotland. I'm sure we'll talk about this later, but we've seen in England nearly a dozen councils effectively going bust. The situation is different in Scotland. You've heard how there are different risk factors, but I don't think we can be complacent about the risk of failure in Scottish councils. As one chief exec told us, it's only a matter of time. And that doesn't just mean the risk of councils actually sort of failing to meet to set their budgets, but also what are they doing in order to stay solvent? I think we have a real risk that we see services cut to a point where they are no longer recognisable, no longer acceptable to service users. So we very much welcome the committee. This is the right time to be having this conversation. We very much welcome the committee looking at it. And we urge, that the government across Scotland really takes account of what we think is actually a perilous situation, but one where we still have time to act before we see councils going over the edge.
Thank you for that. And Abdul.
Thank you for inviting me. You've got my name there, Abdul Kara. I'm Executive Director here at the National Audit Office. My team shadow a number of government departments, including Education, Health, Home Office, and of course, for the purposes of today, what is now the Ministry of Housing, Communities and Local Government. I was previously, spent most of my career in local government, up to and including Chief Executive. So I can draw on kind of that background in terms of a kind of backward look. I obviously also draw on the work of the National Audit Office in terms of our work on local government financial sustainability, our work on governance in local government, on commercial investment and so on, as well as in kind of particular demand areas. So, for example, on homelessness, we produced a report only in July of this year on homelessness, special educational needs, adult social care, and so on, and also draw on my wider kind of experience and knowledge of the sector. Just to be clear, we in the NEO, we don't cover Scotland. So most of my experience will be, or what I'll share with you will be my experience of what's happened in local government and maybe some of the kind of traps and pitfalls to avoid. We're also not the external auditor of individual local authorities in England. They have their own external auditor, but we take more of a kind of systems look on behalf of Parliament.
All right. Thank you very much for that. And that's very helpful, actually, and we can consider what questions we direct to you. We'll try to direct questions to one or other of you initially, but if you would like to come in, type R in the chat function, and then the clerks can let me know, and I'll bring you in. We've got about 90 minutes for this discussion. And obviously, the point of this panel is to understand what's happened to some English local authorities and hear about those lessons learned in terms of our financial sustainability for Scotland. So I'd like to begin by asking around the if you, I think this one's going to be for Jonathan, if you've identified drivers of financial weakness identified in Scotland that are similar to those in councils in England and Wales, and are there differences between the Scottish and English local government finance environment which could impact on financial sustainability?
Yeah, thank you. So I think the simple answer is there are a lot of common factors. So when we look at some of those key drivers of demand, so whether that's an ageing population, whether that's an increasing number of special educational needs provision, whether it's challenges around homelessness and temporary accommodation, those are some of the things that are really driving where demand is going up and cost is going up for councils. So that's sort of driving the kind of spending of councils ever upwards. Those are common factors across England and Scotland, and indeed across much of the world. So many of those factors would apply in Ireland or Australia, for example, particularly around housing. When we look at workforce, the challenges of actually getting the right people into place, those are common factors. But again, I think that comes across a bit more strongly in Scotland. So a real kind of recruitment crisis for local government, and again, driving pay ever upwards, as have recent pay awards. So those are particularly Scottish factors. I think the thing that comes through in our survey that is very different in Scotland is 97% of respondents saying, look, ring fencing, government ring fencing, telling us what we have to spend our money on. And as you'll have heard from other witnesses, you know, the big thing, you know, the emblematic thing, people really worried about teacher numbers. They told you've got to spend this money on maintaining teacher numbers, whether you feel you need to or not. So 97% of the people who responded to our survey, so almost all of them, identified ring fencing as a really big driver of financial pressure. That is different in Scotland. We don't see that in other places. There are some differences within the English context that aren't present in Scotland but have been crucial in some councils going bust. So we don't see councils carrying the same level of sort of risk in commercial investments that we've seen in some English councils. So a council like Woking, which, you know, for those who don't know it, is a relatively small council in Surrey, effectively having £2 billion, with a B, billion, deficit because of commercial investments they've made. So, you know, really significant levels of debt that fails the service. Similar story in Thurrock. So those are different. Those don't apply in the Scottish context. There has been more consistency of audit in Scotland, and that, again, is different. But many of the key factors are sitting there. So, you know, one of the big factors in Birmingham, for example, which is still unclear quite how this is going to pan out, was around equal pay claims. Yeah, we've also seen that impacting Scottish councils. So I think there are differences, but a lot of the underlying factors around demand and sort of are common between Scotland and England. They have driven many English councils, a dozen or so English councils, over the edge financially. They haven't yet done that in Scotland, but I don't think we should be complacent. The fact that Scottish councils don't carry the same commercial lending risk, for example, doesn't mean that some of those other factors aren't really putting pressure on Scottish local government finance.
Thanks very much for that. So just to continue on that, the kind of differences piece, I'll start with Jonathan and Abdul. Maybe you can come in as well on this one. The lack of general power of competence for Scottish councils is often cited as a weakness, and we've had quite a number of councillors are in the room saying that that's something that's the next step that would be helpful in terms of raising revenue. However, LGRU has stated that this may be a reason why Scottish local authorities are not exposed to commercial risk. So I'd be interested to hear from you initially, Jonathan, what are the benefits of a general power of competence, and do these outweigh the risks?
Right. I mean, it's a really interesting question. It is certainly true that Scottish councils would not be able to borrow in the same way as English councils because they don't have that power. But I think actually what's more, you know, the English councils were also doing that in a policy environment that very much pushed them in that direction. So we saw a consistent application of government policy post-2010 saying, look, councils need to be more entrepreneurial. Councils need to need to be, you know, inserted into the economy. They need to be incentivized to grow economies. Councils should receive less. And of course, in England, we've seen council grant from central government reduced by around 40%. And so there was a definite direction of policy travel saying councils should be more reliant on their own resources. And at the same time, they have the power of competence that enables them to act on that. That has led some councils into very risky situations. It's worth saying that many, many councils carry significant commercial debt who have not gone bust. So I think the power of competence, you know, the point is there's an intersection between the powers councils have and the sort of political, the policy environment that they're inserted into. So in a scenario in which you are told you have to make your money work harder for you, then the power of general competence is the mechanism you will use to make decisions. Those should still be properly risk assessed. They should still be, you know, be scrutinized. And I think there are failings of governance. You know, it would be, no one is more, sticks up for local government more than I do, but you cannot look at some of the places that have issued 114s and say, hey, you know, no problem there, it was all bad luck. You know, there have been failures of poor decisions making. The power of competence is one of the things that enabled those decisions to be made. But I think there's no, you know, you have to think of it as, you have to, I think, if you're arguing for it, as we would, you have to say, look, we want the general power of competence, but that, of course, needs to operate in an environment where there's proper scrutiny, proper accountability, proper challenge. It's not a license to make bad decisions.
Thank you. Abdul, do you want to come in on this?
Yes, very happy to. I mean, you may have some further specific questions on commercial investment, but just to kind of underline some of the points Jonathan has made. There was an exhortation to the sector to become more entrepreneurial, plus, of course, the financial pinch. So authorities who didn't want to cut services or other forms of provision were looking to generate other forms of income. One of the ways in which they could do that was through commercial investment and through trading. Almost all authorities in the UK now have trading companies. But by no means, you know, only a minority of those have got into kind of financial difficulty, particularly one or two housing ones. But broadly speaking, if you're, you know, if you set up a company to collect commercial waste alongside domestic waste, most of those kind of things have worked, but not necessarily generated a huge amount of money. The problems have come where massive amounts of commercial investment have gone in and haven't been, you know, there wasn't enough due diligence in advance. There wasn't enough scrutiny, as Jonathan says, and challenge to that. And if you look at what the Treasury has done around public sector works, loans and so on, it's generally been kind of after the fact. So instead of there being checks and balances in advance of loans coming out of Treasury, which of course were cheaper loans than loans on the market, for authorities to invest in commercial investment like Woking, like Thurrock, as Jonathan has said, and there are many others that are out there that are they've either issued Section 114s or they're in significant amounts of debt and in danger of issuing Section 114s, and indeed with delayed external audit reporting because of the demise of the audit external audit market in England. We haven't had some of that data in the public domain for 3 or 4 or 5 years, where auditors haven't been able to gather the data to express an opinion on whether those investments were justified or not. So we saw a lot of mistakes being made, and then a tightening up of, so for example, prudential borrowing rules, of authorities being required to have an investment strategy that's agreed at full council through extra checks and balances on PS, public sector works, loan board loans, and so on and so forth. So there's been a case of kind of trying to shut the stable door after the horse has bolted, I think, on this. The other thing we saw in our commercial investment study was a lot of herd behaviour So authorities would see, you know, their next door neighbour or authority down the road borrowing to invest in, for example, office buildings or that sort of thing, and then the leader or chief executive of the other authority saying, well, we should be doing that because it looks like a good idea. So there was this kind of chasing of each other and herd behaviour without the due diligence, and it's no surprise, I think, in that atmosphere that mistakes were made.
That's very interesting. I just want to come back on, I don't know who wants to answer this. Maybe I'll start with Jonathan because you mentioned it. So you were saying that powers of general competence should be properly scrutinised. So if we were to move to that in Scotland, who do you think should pick that up?
Well, I think, you know, you need effective scrutiny within councils. That's what, you know, that's one of the many things that elected members are there to do. And I think for me, it's not about, I think it's very challenging if you try and say, look, we're going to scrutinize all of this from the center. We're going to build, you know, complex mechanisms to ensure that councils are doing the right thing. I think that is a way, that is a sure recipe for sort of crushing innovation, the crushing sort of interesting practice. But what you do need to do is to make sure that councils have the ability, that councillors have the right training, that councils have the right guidance, so that you have scrutiny working within the local authority. I think that's where we have missed it occasionally in England. It's not the case. You know, the central government has now set up Offlog and it got rid of the audit commission. But there's this constant sort of moving of the deck chairs in terms of centralised accountability mechanisms. What's important is that councils are accountable downwards to the communities that vote for them, and that is the job of elected members. Do they always do that as well as they should? No, they don't. But what we should therefore do is support them to do it better, not try and create cumbersome central government monitoring processes.
Okay, thanks. Abdul, anything to add?
Well, I agree with Jonathan that at least in the first instance, authorities, we should assume competence unless an authority has demonstrated a lack of competence, and then you might want some sort of intervention or control mechanism. That's through the statutory officers. I'm not entirely certain if the same provisions exist in Scotland as they do in England in terms of the monitoring officer, the Section 151 finance officer, and in terms of the head of pay service, but that the protections for those three to A, be competent in their professions, but B, be able to kind of speak truth to power about whether, you know, investment proposition X is a good idea or not, coupled with scrutiny, coupled with an effective audit and risk committee, coupled with an effective external audit function, all of those you would expect in 9 out of 10 cases would be enough to, you know, alongside a competent, you know, investment strategy and so on, would suggest that an authority is likely to be making good decisions. But what has happened in England has demonstrated that the system also needs some controls at a central level that can keep oversight of how the system is working, and certainly spot issues earlier than happened in England. We started in England to see issues happening with commercial investment, for example, and trading several years before the government then stepped in and started to tighten up the controls. So kind of early warning systems and so on. But I agree with Jonathan. The first place to start is to establish competency and kind of professional expectations within the authority.
Thanks very much for that. Jonathan, you've talked at times about an increased basket of different local revenue options, and it would be interesting to hear what you mean by that and what lessons we could learn from other countries and how could this basket of options work in a Scottish context.
Right. So I think it is important that we look at what they do successfully in other places. And I think, you know, we talked a lot about, in the first part of the conversation, about those examples in England where local authorities have made perhaps wrong decisions around investment. We shouldn't allow that to distract us from the fact that there are systemic challenges around local government finance in England. And I often say, you know, the previous UK government was very quick to point the finger at councils that had failed financially say, look, bad decisions, they're bad councils. I think in a broken system, inevitably the places that make the worst decisions fall over first, but that doesn't mean the system isn't broken. So we do need to look much more broadly at both the revenue side of the account and at how we reduce demand in councils. On the question, we've done quite deep dives into working with the University of Northumbria, looking at how local government finance systems work in places like Germany, Italy, Japan. And we've identified some of the sort of common features of successful systems. And you're quite right to say that one of them is a broader range of revenue sources. So councils, we see councils, it's gone very reliant on the combination of council tax and central government funding. What we see in other places is a broader range of local taxation. So whether that might be local sales taxes, whether it might be hotel taxes, and we've made some progress in Scotland towards a visitor levy, looking at cruise ship levy, you have those sort of taxation options. We can also look, you see other jurisdictions where they have assigned shares of national taxation. So you say, well, local government, this is how they do it in Germany, I believe, local government delivers X percent of public services, therefore we have an appropriate percentage of national taxation that's wired across from central government. So there's a whole range of things that you can do that build up that local revenue source. You could look at municipal bonds, for example. All of these things, by the way, if we look at local sales taxes, municipal bonds, local green taxes, visitor levies, these are all things that are commonplace in comparable jurisdictions, in crazy places like the US and France and Germany and Spain. They're not, we treat them in this country as kind of radical blue sky ideas. They're very normal around the world. And there's no reason why they can't, so some of those are complex. Municipal bonds, really, that's a big central government, that's a big project. But some of them are things that councils could just easily be allowed to do. Low taxes, low, on bins, on rubbish, on waste, low ability to set planning fees differently. There's a whole range of small but cumulatively impactful revenue streams that we could open up to local government.
Thanks for that, Donovan. Abdul, do you have any inspiration on the basket of measures?
I don't know about inspiration, just a couple of thoughts that Jonathan sort of triggered. I mean, the first is, as you know, the NAO doesn't comment on policy, but it is true to say that all funding mechanisms for local government are a balance between what is raised locally and what is either shared out nationally through grant or competed for nationally through, tournament funding. That's usually more on the capital side, although sometimes on the revenue side. So those are policy choices for any parliamentary system to make for it. In England, we've clearly seen a shift from centrally provided funding towards more locally provided funding. That's largely but not wholly been through the social care precept. And it's definitely true to say that that England is an outlier in funding social care, but adult social care I'm talking about here, adult social care through property taxes. That is a real anomaly, and in our view doesn't make a huge amount of sense. It's also true that the more that funding is uncertain and short-term and competed for, that militates against authorities or the system more broadly achieving value for money. So that's one point. The second point is Jonathan's point about demand pressures. A system can only be sustainable if you look at both sides of the ledger, as it were, the money that's coming in, but also the what it needs to be spent on. And certainly in England, we see broken systems. Special educational needs is a good example. Homelessness is a good example. Adult social care is another good example. Three of them, and to some extent, but a less extent, children's social care. So what we're seeing is the greatest drivers of demand and cost are in themselves broken systems. So unless those systems are revised and improved in order to better prevent and manage demand, it's very, very difficult for the kind of spending side of the ledger to keep up with the demand that is coming through the door. And that's the kind of hand-to-mouth existence that we're seeing many local authorities in England living.
OK, thank you very much for that. I'm just going to dig in there a little bit, but mindful of not getting too much into kind of the weeds and the detail, but both of you have talked about this reducing demand. And Abdul, there you identified three particular areas in England. But I just, so where do we start in that reducing demand? And which one? I mean, it's difficult, right? How do we begin to do that?
Well, you have to break into these circles in some way. So let's take, for example, I mean, homelessness is a good example. In England, we arguably have fewer homes than we need, certainly several million per by head of population than other comparable authorities in the OECD. Instead, we're spending a huge amount of money on temporary accommodation and on housing benefit. So, standing outside of that system, you'd think that didn't make a huge amount of sense. So investing more in social, in housing generally, but social housing in particular, would help to kind of break that system. But that, I'm not suggesting that's easy at all. It isn't. It will be very difficult and will require additional investment. Take something like special educational needs. There was a new set of opportunities for people and entitlements for people introduced, I think, in 2014. Government of the day woefully underestimated the amount of demand that was going to come through that system. That has essentially, close to bankrupted a number of authorities in England. I know Jonathan said that there have been around about a dozen Section 114s. If the special educational needs deficits that sat on local authority books hadn't been given a special exemption, there would be many, many more authorities with Section 114s in the UK. The previous government did not have a solution, did not understand that increased demand, particularly post-pandemic, did not have a solution to that financing problem. And of course, the new government is kind of grappling and getting their heads around that. So those are broken systems. Adult social care. There were proposals in the 2014 Act, 2011 Act, which we haven't seen implemented. I'm not saying they were the right ones, but it's a well-known story that for several governments in the UK over, different parties and over many years have failed to adequately grasp the social care nettle in the UK. That there's a kind of negative relationship between health and social care. A lack of social care creates costs for health. A lack of well-managed health creates costs for social care. In some way, that system has to be kind of broken into and reset in some way. There are many options on the table. There have been many commissions over the years putting options on the table. At some point, the government has to grasp that nettle. So there are no easy options here, but these are huge problems. If any one of them was solved, I would say particularly adult social care, but if any one of them were solved, it would provide the breathing room to start to solve the other ones.
Thanks very much for that. Jonathan, do you have anything to add in terms of how we break into the system and reduce demand?
Yeah, I mean, this is literally the sort of billion-dollar question, or the £580 million question. And just to add, by the way, yeah, Abdul's point about those exemptions for children's services deficits, those expire in March 26, and we don't know. The government hasn't yet confirmed if they're going to be renewed. That's within the next financial year. So you could conceivably see a whole raft of 114s happening in December. I think Abdul's right. Look, the whole point about this is you need to take a systems approach to it. And you need to sort of, and all these questions, whether it's about greater revenue, wide range of revenue sources, whether it's about funding reform, whether it's about demand management, we need to see it in a whole system approach. And that's really hard. But I think the way to break into that is to look at it on a place basis. Because trying to manage a whole system across a whole country, even a relatively small country, is really challenging. You need to look at it at a place-based level. So you can start to join up services. You can start to make the shift that when we talk about these big challenges, these big demographic challenges like adult social care, you can't spend your way out of that. You need to move to a system that is preventative, that helps people to live independently for longer, that enables people to be in their own homes, that enables communities to support each other. It can't just be delivered by central or local government. And I think that means you need to operate at the level of place so you can start to join up. So we did a piece of work, God, 12 years ago now for the UK Parliament looking at adult social care, and people kept talking about the £20 grab rail, right? So a local authority goes around and puts grab rails in the homes of all the older people in the community. It costs them 20 quid a pop. It's not a huge amount of money, but it's money. You can be really accurate in predicting how many falls that will save. You can be really accurate in predicting how many hospital admissions that will save and the costs of that. But the challenge, and this remains true to this day, is that that's local authority spend and it's NHS savings. And for all the sort of various convoluted changes we've made to health governance, you know, we have ICBs now in England, you have joint integrated health boards, you know, we've still never solved that basic problem of how do you make the money flow around the system so that people can actually invest to save, people can actually, you know, put money into prevention. We have what I call pilot purgatory, but we have all these great pilots of stuff going on, but we never systematize that. You have to start at places because that's the only scale you can do that join up at.
Great, thank you very much for that. Now I'm going to bring in Emma Roddick with a couple of questions.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I wondered how long in advance of the issuing of the Section 114 notices down south was there concern that this point might be reached, and what were the warning signs that might have been spotted?
Well, I would say it varies in each case. I think there was general concern in the sector when we started to see the increase in borrowing for commercial investment. It should be said that not all of the Section 114s were around commercial investment. A couple were for poor allocations of budget, so budget spending that wasn't basically allowed within the rules. But the majority of those that have been issued were around debt caused by commercial investment, and there were definitely sort of rumours and concerns within the sector that an authority at some point would get into trouble. That was, you know, that was, I would say, spotted several years in advance of any individual authority issuing a Section 114. Of course, the first one to be issued was itself a big, you know, became a big kind of cause célèbre in the sector, given that one hadn't been issued since, I think, 2001, which was me. So then we went for 15 years or something like that without a Section 114. So it was a big thing for an authority to do. And then once one was issued, then several were issued around the country. Even in authorities where Section 114s weren't issued, the government has sent in kind of best value in where they have concerns, where they have sort of soft intelligence that there might be an issue. They've sent in best value investigators and best value commissioners to try to help the authority to turn itself around, either to prevent a Section 114 or to ensure that there's swift action once a Section 114, which looked as if it was about to be issued once it was issued. So were there all early warning signals? Yes, there were. Could there have been more? We think so. I've mentioned already the failure of external audit within England. We've seen a real drop-off in the levels of external assurance being able to be provided by the due date each year, and indeed some authorities that haven't had an external auditor annual report for 5 years now. We certainly saw a drop-off in the number of public interest reports that external auditors were providing, and so some of those early warning signals, whether to the authority itself, whether to the public, whether to the department and to Parliament, were non-existent.
So you said there about kind of warnings years in advance and that kind of rumour and low-level concerns must exist pretty much all the time around financial decisions. When should councils begin to really worry and take action about those? And does it need to be more specific and geared towards the current example rather than generalised worry about specific practices?
Well, I think we're largely past the point where external commercial investment is going to be the driver of Section 114. There may be two or three still out there, but not very many. Those have largely been surfaced. I think we're more now in the regime where demand pressures, which I mentioned in one of my responses earlier, demand pressures upon services are unable to be managed, are far beyond the kind of annual budget available to authorities, and then that's the risk where Section 114s will possibly apply. Authorities in those positions well know their financial predicaments and are predicting them with, you know, in year budget reports that are predicting overspends at the end of the year, running down reserves perhaps over several years to such a point at which they can no longer do that. And again, that intelligence is available to the department in England to be able to kind of step in and offer help. We've seen things like financial reviews by the LGA and SIPFA of authorities that are looking for support to see if there's anything new and innovative they can do. We've seen exceptional financial support from the government go to several English authorities, which is essentially sort of poor accounting practice in allowing authorities to borrow capital in order to fund revenue services. We think that's, you know, a road to ruin if that continues. So I think looking ahead, most authorities that are in financial sort of dire straits know that. Most of them are doing everything that they possibly can to head that off, but some will not be able to, and that information is largely in the public domain through one means or another.
Are the notices and the lead-up to them being issued likely to change in accounting guidance practices or legislation?
I'm not close enough to that, but having gone through a couple of years of kind of testing some of the accounting practices as we seek to recover the external audit market and what needs to happen to simplify that in order to kind of catch up on the backlog, I'm not expecting significant accounting practice changes in England through SIPFA, LASAC, and other boards like that.
Lessons that are being learned or looked at here in response?
Here being Scotland?
Yes.
That I don't know.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Emma. Jonathan.
Right, so there's a lot here. And you, without wishing to be flippant, if the question is when should you start worrying about this, the answer is yesterday. Last year, the year before, and councils are worrying about this. And that's the point. Councils in Scotland, as in England, are crying out and saying, this is not a sustainable system. We are, you know, we are heading for these situations. Individual councils, yes, there were rumours about some councils, but the overall system, we've been doing these surveys since 2012, and we've seen the proportion of people who are confident in their council's financial sustainability dropping year on year. We've seen the proportion of councils that are reserves, dipping into reserves year after year, increasing. So all the warning signs across, again, it's about, you know, taking a sector-wide systems approach. All the warning signs have been there that this is a broken system. In terms of what happens in individual authorities, I think one of the challenges we've seen in England, and there are lessons for Scotland here, one of the challenges in England is that the 114 process is very binary, right? So it's a legal duty on the Section 151 officer, normally the head finance officer, when they come to believe that the council will not be able to meet its obligations based on the income they currently envisage, they have to issue a 114, at which point basically all hell breaks loose. So it's this very kind of yes-no sort of thing. They're very reluctant to do it, but then they have to, and it's very sudden in that sense. So even though there's warning signs and rumours, the actual process is very sudden. That wouldn't apply in Scotland because you don't have that 114 process. So how would all this work in Scotland? We don't really know because it hasn't happened yet. We've been doing some work with CIPFA. We've got a report coming out in October, working with chief financial officers across Scotland that tries to sort of flesh that out. But I think what we need, and one of the things in England is talking about, is what the minister I heard yesterday refer to as recovery and reform partnerships, possibly reform and recovery, recovery and reform partnerships, which are processes where you can have a more honest dialogue between councils and central government about support they might need ahead of a 114 process. And I think the challenge we've had in England is that councils are like, no, we're okay, we're okay, we're okay, we're not okay. And actually what we need, and this I think is what government in Scotland could learn from, could get ahead of the game on, is that process where you enable a frank conversation that puts support in ahead of the 114 or the Scottish equivalent thereof being issued. That's really important, I think. It's a thing we've failed to do in England over the last 6 years since Northamptonshire issued that 114 in 2018. The new government is talking about introducing that in England. I think that is something that Scotland could very easily kind of pick up and get and be a sort of pathfinder on.
Okay, thanks so much for that. We'll take that on board. Noted. In terms of the frank conversations, I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to you both. I wonder if I could just continue briefly on the discussion that Emma Roddick led there and using some of the examples from our Welsh councils. As I understand it, the Welsh councils are saying that they are less likely to end up in a bankrupt situation compared to their English council counterparts due to their closer relationship to central government. And I just wondered if you could offer an explanation, because we don't have our Welsh colleagues in front of us. What do they mean by that? Is it a tighter financial relationship that they have with the Welsh Assembly, or what? What do you understand that they meant by that?
I don't feel able to. I don't really understand what they meant by that, I'm afraid.
Anything to add?
I mean, I don't know the specifics of that example, but certainly from the days when I worked and covered the Welsh area, the there's two factors. One is there are many fewer local authorities in Wales, 22 or something along those lines. So it's far easier for Scottish Parliament to have a kind of picture of what's happening locally. Secondly, because it's a much smaller country and the kind of chains of the politics, the connections between the parliament and the kind of leaders of councils and so on were fairly short chains of kind of linkages. And therefore, I would expect that local intelligence is better in any case in Wales. Whether that's what they were kind of pointing at in that particular comment, I have no idea. But that has been the case in Wales.
I mean, I'll just go in there. That this particular councillor is the head of Cardiff City or Cardiff Council, and he said higher central funding from the Welsh Government has helped them stay afloat when some English councils are collapsing. I mean, that's quite a statement to make. So clearly he in Wales thinks there's a better relationship with central government there that's avoided the disasters that some of the English councils have encountered. Well, Abdul, is there anything you could add to that?
So there's a relationship issue, but you're right that in terms of funding, there have been less cuts. Cuts have bitten less deeply in Wales on local authorities than they have in England. And also in Wales, grant funding is a greater feature of the system than, as I said earlier, in England, a move to raising the social care funding through a social care precept added onto council tax. So that's not been a feature in Wales in the same way. So the more that local government is funded by grant from central government, in this case the Welsh government, then it's in the hands of of that government as to whether it wishes to cut it as much or not. But what I haven't done is a compare and contrast exercise between the two comparing levels of cuts. So I can't give you any figures, I'm afraid.
Okay, it's maybe something we can follow up on if we get the opportunity later. Could I come back to talk about the audit function? And of course, you've mentioned a few times that the Audit Commission was disbanded in England in 2015. How much can you say that that decision may have led to these problems that particularly the English councils have faced? But we know that audit hasn't disappeared. The audit function is prevalent at every level of local government. So why, when the Audit Commission disappeared in 2015, did it lead to these circumstances unfolding in England, or is it nothing to do with that, would you say?
I guess I should declare an interest in having previously been employed by the Audit Commission, so I have a great love for that institution and the time I spent there. I think there definitely is a connection between the two kind of events in a couple of ways. So when the Audit Commission was disbanded and district audit that existed as kind of within the Audit Commission, in England we moved to a market approach to providing external audit, and the tendering process for external audit was such that there was a significant amount of competition and prices were driven very low through that first tender. That would have been around about 2014, I would say, 2014, 2015. And it turns out, with retrospect and hindsight, that those audit fees were pushed so low through that tender process that a number of providers of audit weren't able to provide the service that they had tendered for. So it would be true to say that to some extent, external audit did not so much disappear as was less comprehensive than it was prior to that tendering exercise. Of course, prior to that, it was a function that was district audit was funded through the Audit Commission, which in turn charged fees to local authorities. So we have definitely seen the demise of external audit in England. So if you look at the number of audits that are provided by the due date, completed and certified by the due date each year, that went up from virtually zero, certainly handfuls, in the late 2009, 2010, those sort of years, upwards of many hundreds by the statutory deadline last year. Hence, in England, we've had to bring in these new provisions around backstop dates. So a large number of audits this year will not be able to be completed, and work on them will cease. So there has been a real demise of that external audit function. So that's one area that the demise of the Commission had a direct effect upon. The other function of the Commission, which was around providing comparative data and good practice guides for local government, also disappeared. And it's difficult to say to what extent that was a feature of the system pre-2010 that kept local government sort of healthy and so on, but I think it certainly did play a function. And, you know, authorities were very interested in how they performed comparable to others, and indeed how they spent money and how efficient they were comparable to other authorities of a similar kind. And there is very little reporting along those lines in the public domain in the same way these days, although the local government association does have a sort of online data function, I think called Insight, which provides some of that, but certainly not with the same kind of heft and impact that the Audit Commission did.
That's really thorough, Abdul, in your explanation there. What I was thinking of when you were explaining that is, why didn't the internal audit function in some place like Woking not wake up earlier to the prospect that they were about to go £2 billion in the red? What's happening with the internal audit function there?
That's a really good question. Like most back office functions in local authorities, through the kind of austerity years, you know, they were significantly cut, stripped to the bone. I know in the authority where I was chief executive, we entered into a shared internal audit function, which managed to just about preserve our internal audit function, but with some compromises, I think. So internal audit functions have been also stripped to the bone, like other corporate services, in order to try to protect, you know, frontline services and frontline provision. And, you know, I think it was questionable, at least in some places, the value that was given to internal audit and those kind of assurance mechanisms that authorities should be relying on. I mean, you know, how one of the things we found in our report on governance was, you know, not great data on how well audit and risk committees performed, for example. That, you know, they're not the most effective committee that local authorities tend to run. Very few have an independent external person on the committee, for example, or indeed a chair with an accountancy qualification of some kind. So audit and risk committees are not as strong as they should be. Internal audit is not as strong as it used to be, and external audit is also not as strong as it used to be.
Goodness, thank you for that. My last query for you is really about general financial sustainability indicators. If I could just ask for some comment from you both on that. Our Improvement Service in Scotland publishes these to help guide us. Do you think that the financial sustainability indicators that we all collectively use are fit for purpose? Do we need to think differently about what financial sustainability looks like in the medium to long term, and what kind of things should we perhaps introduce to get a better and more rounded picture of what we need to know?
Thanks, Jonathan. I mean, I have to say I don't know off the top of my head exactly which indicators you use. I'm sure they're probably quite similar to what we would use in England, that SIPFA would use, that the LGA would use, that the department itself would use, and so on. Things like the rate at which reserves are being run down, the level of borrowing and servicing of borrowing, and those sorts of things. What I would say, and it links to something Jonathan said earlier, I would talk more about the incentives. What are the incentives for an authority to admit that it's in trouble? I think those incentives are generally in the wrong place. It's seen as a failure. It's seen as maybe as an ego thing for the leader and the chief executive. It's seen as inviting intervention and so on. Instead, we should have systems and mindsets that where people are prepared to kind of signal early that they may be getting into issues and seek help and advice and guidance and so on. So those incentives, I think, are probably, you know, can be in the wrong place in certain circumstances. You know, that's what happened in England, as Jonathan said. You know, authorities claiming everything is fine until the day that it isn't, and the, you know, receivers are brought in or whatever.
Jonathan?
Yeah, look, I totally agree with Abdul about that. And actually, this goes back to the whole bigger question of what's the relationship between central and local government. And it continues in Scotland, as in England, as in Wales. It's this terribly kind of a parent-child relationship where local government is dependent on central government. And so the incentives are never there to have a grown-up, honest conversation about what's working and what's not, because that's just not how the relationship is set up. It's not a relationship of equals, and we need to move it to being much more like that. Are the indicators right? I think the question is not, have we got the right indicators? It's what are we doing with them? You know, across all the indicators we have, government in Scotland, in London, should be screaming red flags. You know, this is a system that is heading for disaster. And we talked, you know, it's really important to have the conversation about audit and what's working, what's not. But we shouldn't allow that to distract us from the sort of basic, you know, facts here. In Scotland, there's an estimated 580 million budget gap. We talked about Wales and they feel they're better off. They still have the Welsh LGA says they have a 432 million pound budget gap. In England, the LGA talks about a 2 billion gap. But these are sort of fundamental underlying realities that, yes, we can improve audit, yes, we can improve systems, yes, we can improve indicators. But actually, if we want to, we need to act on those core underlying structural realities. And at the end of the day, the reality is that across the UK, local government does not have enough money to do the things that it is being asked to do. So we either need to find different ways of funding it, or we need to ask it to do less, or we need to do radical transformation to the way we deliver those services, or some combination of all three. And, you know, you can have the best audit and scrutiny in the world, but it's only going to allow you, you know, you can get better at spotting what's going on, but we need to act on those core basic facts.
I mean, finally, Jonathan, I don't want to pick on poor old Woking, but were their financial stability indicators not ringing alarm bells along this process of racking up a £2 billion deficit? Did they have any indicators at all that might alert them to that?
I mean, they knew what they'd borrowed, right? And they knew what they had coming in. I think Woking, the thing about Woking, right, is because it has such a big number attached to it, it becomes emblematic. And I've also used it in a sort of, you know, slightly unfair kind of thing. I don't think Woking is a bit of an outlier. The issue is, now, I would look at places like Nottingham, a place, you know, that are... The challenge we've got to in England is, have we got to a point where only a council that gets nothing wrong can survive financially? If that is the scenario we are in, I would suggest we're heading for, you know, there is no council. You can't have a council that never makes any mistakes. You can't have a perfectly run council. So, you know, yes, Woking is an extreme example, but what we're seeing across England are quote-unquote well-run councils who are now perilously, have either issued 114s or are perilously close. And when we did our survey in England this year, we asked, if nothing changes, are you going to issue a 114 over the next 5 years? Right? Not coincidentally, the lifetime of the parliament. 51% of English councils say that if nothing changes in the local government funding system, they will be bust within 5 years. That, you know, that takes us beyond a conversation about what a particular council's got wrong and forces us into a conversation about why aren't we adequately funding local public services.
Okay. Thanks very much to both of you for that. Thank you. Convener.
Thanks, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosol with questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Dr. Jonathan, from the survey you carried out with local authorities, you mentioned the picture in Scotland is very bleak on finances with local government. Could you suggest any possible next steps to improve the financial sustainability of councils in Scotland? And how can potential financial risks be mitigated? And it would be also great to hear from Abdul as well, if there's any sort of experience that he's seen somewhere else, that to hear about that.
Sure. So one of the things I would do is just point to some key lessons that we draw from looking at places where this works better. Lesson one, you need a clear constitutional definition of the role of local government, central government, who's doing what. Verity House sort of promised us we might get some of that, but we might talk about Verity House and whether it's delivered later. Lesson two, we've already talked about, you need a broader basket of revenue-raising options, not just as some one-off pots of funding, but as a stepping stone to a sort of broader reform. Lesson three, you need to really embed subsidiarity. So you need a bottom-up approach, and you need that to be bedded in. Lesson four, you need an effective system of territorial equalisation, redistribution between different councils according to need. And lesson five, you need a set way, a standing body, a set forum in which local government and central government can have these honest, helpful conversations. So you're taking funding out of a kind of annual political kind of horse trading and into a set system, what we sometimes call embedded autonomy. So councils have freedom of manoeuvre fiscally, but within a system that everyone understands and that has predictable outcomes. Those are all things, you know, and it's easy to look at those other countries and say, well, they have constitutions that enable. Those are all things I think you can do within our rather odd unwritten constitution, one of only seven countries in the world that doesn't have a written constitution. But those are all things that actually we could do in Scotland.
I mean, I think Jonathan is absolutely spot on. I couldn't, agree more with that set of principles. I would love to see those applied in England as well. I mean, I think the only thing I would add in terms of a kind of a principle is, thinking about what in theory should council tax pay for versus what should grant pay for versus what should service users themselves pay for. I think we have a very muddled system of thinking around those three kind of forms of income. Of course, we can talk about other forms of income, like a local, a share of local income tax or stamp duty or VAT or whatever, and so on. But just, so for example, I don't think anyone would disagree that if somebody was, going for a swim at a leisure centre, they should pay for that. Right. I mean, there may be exceptions with, OAP and whatever. But generally speaking, if you're using that kind of service, you should be paying for it through a fee or a charge. Similarly, if the government wants an authority to do something specific, like a new duty, then that should be funded and probably funded through grant versus council tax, which most people would associate with, keeping the place going in terms of street cleansing and waste collection and those sorts of things as well. And if you look at things like, certainly in England, I don't know the case in Scotland, but in England you look at something like planning fees, where planning fees are set by government in England, and most authorities, for most authorities, the planning fees that are set by central government do not cover the cost of determining that planning application. That means that the gap has to be covered by council tax, and that means that council taxpayers are subsidising those who want to do development. Now, I think in principle, there's a conversation to be had about whether that's right or not. So alongside Jonathan's five themes that he put there, I would put that one on the table as well. Let's have an in-principle, I'd suggest an in-principle discussion about what form of funding is right to fund what form of service delivery. Of course, capital grants are a separate thing.
Thank you. Abdul, can I just probe a little bit more into this? Obviously, you've seen councils in England, and in a past life, I've worked with local authorities in England. Just about good practice, have you seen any good practice about shared resources, whether it's software, systems? I know my colleague Miles Briggs mentioned earlier on bin services even shared. I know local enterprise partnerships, I don't know if they're still around, but certainly that they work together, whether it's the South East or any other area, to look at where savings can be made and also where they can work on development better and services. So do you have any sort of good practice that shows that councils have saved money coming together and sharing resources and working together?
Yeah, so there was certainly a big movement in the 2010s around sharing services. Certainly the authorities the authority I ran alongside our neighbour authorities, we had a number of shared services, all of which were pretty successful and saved money. Did they save enough money to mean that I didn't have to make cuts each year? No, they didn't. But were they a form of efficiency and effectiveness? I think they are. I would say that There is good practice in England, but there aren't very good mechanisms for sharing good practice. We talked about the demise of the Audit Commission a couple of questions ago. That was one way in which good practice was shared. The LGA, the Local Government Association in England, do a little bit of that. We see some of the professional bodies, like the Association of Directors of Adult Social Care, or the Directors of Children's Social Care, or ADEPT, which is the Association of Directors of Environment, Planning and Transport, and they also do housing, sharing sort of good practice at a level of the professional. But do I think there are systematic enough processes in England for sharing good practice? No. And I say that even though we have, I haven't got it off the top of my head, but probably 7, 8, 9 What Work centres who do some of that work around sharing good practice, for example, around early intervention or around caring for older people. I think LEPs are the local enterprise partnerships. I think they were much less about efficiency in service delivery. They did very little of that. They were much more of a mechanism for sort of jointly agreeing investment priorities, infrastructure priorities in a place. And in any case, LEPs have been demised as well. They've been folded into combined authorities in England where combined authorities exist.
Thank you. My last question is, Dr. Johnson, again, from the survey you carried out with local authorities, you mentioned workforce challenges. And one of the areas, that was one of the areas that you mentioned, highlighted by councils. My question is on pay deals. How can they be managed more sustainably and strategically, given that employment costs for around 70% of the employment budget?
Yeah, I mean, again, I shouldn't be frivolous in this context, but I might be tempted to ask, could they be managed less sustainably and effectively? Look, you need early consultation. I mean, again, the challenge with pay deals, and as you say, these make a huge difference to local authority budgets. It's yet another thing that local government feels is done to it, not with it. You know, Verity House agreement set out clear principles around early consultation on all these sorts of matters, and I think it's fair to say that local government across Scotland doesn't feel that's being delivered on. So the first thing I would say is that it all comes back to having that. And my point about constitutional definitions, but also central local communications, having a mature relationship between central and local government where these things are discussed ahead of time, and where there's a connection between that and the funding that follows it. So, you know, many people in local government would say yes. Scottish Government says, OK, we increased the funding settlement to local government by 6% last year. But actually, once you factor in the pay deals that had already been agreed, actually in some of the ring fencing, it's effectively a flat cash settlement, which, you know, isn't adequate to the needs that local government currently has. So, you know, pay deals are they are a very major part of the sort of symptomatic of how the whole relationship doesn't work properly and the whole discussion is just happening too late and in the wrong place.
Abdul, can I touch on the England side of this with the pay side? Obviously in Scotland last week we got evidence that pay can be a barrier, councillor pay, especially to ethnic minorities, women and people have a disability. And obviously then they cannot be councillors and we don't have that representation, unfortunately, representing all backgrounds sometimes. And is there anything in England that you see that can help here? Or is it the councillor pay, should it be yearly, 5-yearly, 3-yearly? I mean, is there any example that you can give us that we can basically see that we can work from? A good example, obviously.
Very few good examples, I think. In fact, we saw I'm going to guess the year being 2014 or 15, Jonathan may remember, we had the opposite. We had the Secretary of State of the day deciding to ban the possibility of pensions for councillors being able to access the local government pension scheme, and this reduced the attractiveness of being a councillor in England. We had a very successful model of virtual meetings of councils through the pandemic. But that wasn't allowed to continue post-pandemic, so that's put more people off from being able to be a councillor because it's much less convenient. We've had models of, sort of maternity cover and so on as well, which haven't been sort of broadly taken up. I mean, Jonathan's much closer to the councillor side than I am, but I would say... the mood music has been generally not really positive for councillors over the last 10 or 15 years. Just let me just make one comment on the officer side. Yes, I think that there's an issue around kind of pay for, of course, officers in council should be paid, commensurate rate for the job. Regardless of that, even if that is the case, there is a massive workforce issue in England anyway, whether that's around an ageing population, whether that's around the attractiveness of a local government, whether that's about certain professions. Planning is a really good example, where the professions haven't been able to attract enough people into the profession to cover those who'll be, retiring in the next 5 years and that sort of thing. We've got an absolutely, massive workforce pressures alongside, competing areas. Like if you look at the long-term workforce plan that the NHS in England has recently announced, that's the thick end of 500,000 people expected to be joining the NHS over the next 10 years. I mean, it's, everyone's competing for workforce at the moment. Whether AI or whatever is the kind of round the corner is going to solve the problem, we don't know yet, but it is a general challenge for public sector services.
Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Pam. And I'm now going to bring in Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Convener. Jonathan, you touched on Verity House Agreement earlier in your submission, I think. You talked about the surprise council tax freeze demonstrating a failure of the principles of trust and respect. Now, there's a lot of enthusiasm here in Scotland, particularly in local government, for the Verity House agreement. And so I guess just to ask your opinion on whether the Verity House agreement can be saved, and can it be progressed, can it be turned into something meaningful and something that can be rescued in the eyes of local government at the moment?
Right. So, yes, a good question. And obviously, I don't speak for Scottish local government. They have COSLA to do that for them. I think, look, what I would say about Verity House is I thought it was really exciting. We've talked a lot, as I talked about earlier, about this, having this sort of constitutional definition of the relationship between central and local government. And given that we don't have in this country a written constitution, I thought that Verity House was a really good stab at, I don't know what you'd geekly call it, a sort of sub-constitutional memorandum of understanding between central and local government. So I was really, like many people in Scottish local government, everyone in Scottish local government, I was really enthusiastic about Verity House when it was signed. And indeed, I sort of waved it around in England saying, look at this, why aren't we doing this? But I think the way in which it had, I think it has been disappointing. So, some of those core principles in Verity House, no surprises. And then we have a surprise council tax for early consultation. And, and the First Minister at COSLA conference last week pressed to commit to not having a repeat of that would only say, we'll engage earlier. That early engagement wasn't. So I think there has been, around the council tax freeze, around teacher numbers, those principles of no surprises, of local by default. I think there is a feeling across Scottish local government that Verity House has been honoured more in the breach than in the observance. Can it be rescued? I think it can, because I think, so two things. I think people still think better to have it than not have it. So even when the Scottish government sort of rides roughshod through it, at least you can point back to it and say, well, hang on, guys, you know, we had an agreement. You're breaking an agreement. That's better than not having it there in the first place. And I think, and I'm going slightly out on a limb, this is my kind of interpretation, rather, I'm not sure I can stand this up. My sense is that there is enough hope and residual goodwill around Verity House that it can be rescued, but I think we really need to see a very obvious demonstration of adherence to it from Scottish Government if that is to be the case. So I hear people saying things, you know, I've asked this question to Scottish local government leaders a lot, you know, is Verity House dead? And that, you know, paraphrasing, they say, it's not dead, but it's pretty poorly. And, you know, and time is running out to revive it.
Okay. Thanks, Jonathan. The other area of kind of agreement between Scottish Government and local government, the work that's been developing has been on a fiscal framework. I just wonder what your understanding of the developments working towards that are, and whether you see it, that that's something to be valued and something for us to push for delivery on.
Yes to the last question. I think it is something we should push on delivery on. I'm not in those negotiations. Speaking to people who are, I think there's a sense that progress is being made, perhaps more slowly than we would have liked, but that we are moving forward. For me, I would love to see that fiscal framework reflecting the sort of five principles I talked about earlier. I think we might get some of them, but you know, again, the point is the framework will, it's like Verity House, right? The framework will only be as good as people's delivery of it. So, you know, and this comes back to, you know, a lot of the questions we've been talking about, you know, scrutiny, audit, you know, warning signals. It's not just about the system, it's about people's willingness and capacity to deliver on it. So, yes, I remain optimistic about the fiscal framework. I think it's a good idea. I hope it lives up to expectation, but I'm not. I think we should be complacent about that.
Okay, thanks. And finally, a question for Abdul and Jonathan. You know, I've talked about the Verity House Agreement, work towards a fiscal framework. That's work that's ongoing here. But is there anything that we should be looking at in the upcoming English Devolution Bill, which we should look to emulate when it comes to the relationship between Scottish central and local government?
Can I just say one thing on the Verity House? I mean, it points to a really interesting sort of underlying set of of incentives. Local government wants certainty not only about its financing but about how things will be done, for example, consulting on changes. Central government wants flexibility, or you know, it's over everything all of the time. So trying to find an agreement that kind of, you know, closes the gap between those two positions is quite difficult. In terms of the devolution bill, the government in England has, you know, very much kind of nailed its colours to the mast that devolution is where it wants to see things going. Now, we largely are seeing that around infrastructure in investment and capital much more than we are seeing that around service delivery, for example. That it wants larger footprint areas on which to deliver some of those kind of strategic subnational investment decisions, and that it wants, in as many cases as possible, there to be a single person, the elected mayor, that it can kind of literally get in a room and you know, negotiate with in a way that is very complicated when you have large numbers of councils and so on. That's one of the reasons why LEPs were so difficult. You know, I worked as part of the South East Local Enterprise Partnership in England for many years, and that had sort of, you know, 50 councillors around the table and all their chief executives and so on. You could, very hard to kind of get business done in that environment. Whether in practice we will see something along the lines of kind of subsidiarity that Jonathan has spoken about, that all things that can be done locally should be done locally rather than held nationally. I don't think we'll see that happen overnight, but I think as these organisations, and don't forget, several of the combined authorities and mayoral combined authorities in England are still, you know, very young, immature organisations. But as they mature, as a level of trust builds or not, but if it does build, I think we will see progressive subsidiarity over time. But that is, you know, fraught with all sorts of dangers. We saw, for example, in the pandemic in England, that the government of the day found it very difficult to be in a kind of political discussion with mayors with who had a very different opinion to the government of the day. And that, I think, did sort of damage relationships or slow the direction of travel for a period of time. So there are all sorts of kind of pressures that might happen along the way. But are we, you know, if I took a 100-year view of this, are we on a journey towards greater subsidiarity, at least to mayoral combined authority level rather than local authority level? Yes, I think we are.
Thank you. So speaking to ministers recently, I think we're expecting the white paper on the devolution bill in November. That in theory, you know, they're talking about that being a co-production with local government, which is great, although there's not much time to do real co-production between now and November. So I think we will see what's in that. It feels to me as though the devolution debate in England is developing very fast. You know, so government have asked for expressions of interest from upper tier authorities by the end of September, so next week, and are then planning to enter into a series of discussions around what devolution deals to combined authority and mayoral, to create new combined authority and mayors. I think a lot will depend. I think the UK government's current position on devolution in England is for people to come forward. And I think a lot will depend on the quality of that. And if they get the plans that work for them, then I think we will see a kind of fairly organic process. If they don't, will we get a more directed process further down the line where they decide what works and start to sort of impose it? I think this is all, you know, we've been following this really, really closely. I've been in facilitating quite a lot of these devolution discussions. And I think what I would say is it's a watch this space because it's moving fast and I'm not sure where it's going to end up. I think there's a lot of uncertainty, a lot of movement, a lot of action, a lot of uncertainty. That uncertainty isn't, by the way, a criticism. It's just that's where we are. We've got a government that's been in place for, 70 days. They're trying to move fast, but the price of moving fast is that it's mobile and uncertain. So I think it's hard to draw lessons from that at this point.
Thank you. Okay. I had another question, but I think it's already been covered in previous responses.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thanks for joining us today. I wanted to ask a couple of questions. Firstly, in relation to restricted capital resources and how you believe councils should prioritise their capital spending, and if you have any examples, for example, around good practice and engaging with communities around that. Whoever wants to come in first. Jonathan, will I start with yourself?
Sure. Look, I think, you know, I'm not an expert on capital allocation and capital spending. I think, you know, the overall point I would make is that if you look at the value of assets held by local government and you look at the capital funding and the disconnect between those things, I think it's becoming clear, as other submissions to your committee have made clear, that there is going to be a big challenge around maintaining the infrastructure that we have, let alone investing in the money we need to invest in new infrastructure. In terms of best practice around consultation on this, look, we can write to the committee with some examples of this, but I think it is fair to say that we have seen the local government has been better at consultation on revenue spending than on capital, is my sense. And I think one of the challenges because we have, and Abdul can speak to accounting practice far more authoritatively than I can. Anyone can speak to accounting practice more authoritatively than I can, actually. But capital and revenue are rightly kept apart. But I do sometimes wonder if they sit too much in different kind of strategic boxes, and we don't think enough about how they interact. Which is not to say that we should mix up those budgets or those funding streams, but I think as a strategic whole place development does need to think about capital investment, infrastructure, public service reform, community engagement, all in one sort of coherent whole. I think that's much easier said than done. And I'm there's nowhere that I would massively point to and say, look, these people have got it right, because I think everyone's on the journey around that.
So Jonathan's right. The kind of essential kind of trade-off with capital is, are you doing new things, are you maintaining existing things? And certainly our work in England has shown that both at a government level, but to some extent also at a local government level, maintenance has been severely underinvested in over the years. You've only just got to look, for example, at the work on RAC, which is a reinforced aerated concrete that we did last year. Coincidentally, both on schools and hospitals, we had two reports come out within a fairly short kind of space, covering RAC in both of those. The RAC has long been known about, hasn't been dealt with, and now we're at a sort of cliff edge where a massive amounts of investment are needed in order to either remedy or replace those schools and those hospitals. And that's also, we can apply the same, it's also been true for roads, it's been true for bridges, it's been true for all sorts of things in England, and I think that's probably also the case in Scotland, where this trade-off happens all the time. I happen to sit on the board of a housing association, and we have exactly the same trade-off between, how much are we investing in kind of remediating existing stock to the decent home standard, or for net zero, or for what's called AWAB's law, so around damp mould and condensation, versus how much are we able to invest in new stock and new provision. So that is always a tension for any investment. I would say, in terms of kind of the funding, I mean, you started by saying that there were limited funding pots. Yes, there are in terms of grant, but do I see opportunities for more funding, whether through Section 106 and developer contributions, through changes to the way in which land value uplift from planning decisions is captured, even through things like venture capital and so on. So I think there are kind of things to explore in terms of additional capital funding. And then finally, you talk about community involvement. I think there is a rich tradition, not on commercial investment, let's put commercial investment aside, but when it comes to regeneration and redevelopment, I think there's a rich tradition in England, certainly, of consulting people on what do they want their town centre to look like, particularly in these days of town centres with many sort of boarded up shops and so on. What does the vision of the town centre look like for the future, or what does the vision for the footprint of an estate that might be demolished but something new put in, what does that look like? I think there's lots of really good examples out there that you could follow up on. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for that. You touched upon RAC, and it was something I wanted to raise with you both in relation to future challenges. We've had pretty bleak conversation around the pressures facing local government already, but where do you think councils are in terms of assessing what that looks like, especially in relation to RAC? I was out in West Lothian meeting with people on Friday affected by RAC, and I just don't think the council necessarily has a figure of what that looks like. Mixed tenure now in many of the developments and we're referring to as well. So just wondered if you have any idea in terms of England what that exposure to risk now looks like for councils and that housing stock, and any figures which might exist for Scotland.
We haven't looked at that in terms of housing. I think it's much less of an issue in housing than it is in schools, for example, because housing authorities who have housing stock, or for example housing associations where that stock has been transferred, have long had programmes of of surveying and investigating issues with their properties, and many buildings have been, you know, demolished and replaced over the years. So I think it is a substantive issue, but I think it's less of a substantive issue than, for example, in schools, where the absolute extent of RAAC is still not very well known, because it's been done on a sort of survey and sampling basis rather than a comprehensive survey of 22,000 schools and all of the buildings associated with those schools. So I think we're in a healthier position in terms of local government housing.
Thanks. Jonathan, anything you want to add to that?
No, I'd agree with that. I think my sense is that local authorities have pretty good data about their housing stock and housing association stock, and that where there are challenges, it's far more in relation to some of the issues Abdul flagged earlier, you know, damp, mould, etc. Those are more than RAAC. But I think local authorities have a pretty good handle on housing.
Thanks for that. There's evidence from the Scottish Household Survey that public satisfaction with local government services has reduced in recent years. And just wondered, is this an experience mirrored in England? And what do you think needs to change to try to reverse this trend? We've touched upon people being more engaged in decision making, things like that. But just wondered, you know, given the pressures local government are facing, that level of satisfaction seems to be on the decline.
There's definitely true in England too. The local government association produces an annual survey, and the trajectory has been downwards. So satisfaction has been dropping. Now, what do we think has caused that? A couple of things, at least. First of all, you know, local people will have seen, you know, libraries close and day centres close and, you know, few shorter opening hours in those sorts of things, you know. So there's definitely been a sort of, and perhaps some of the street scene stuff as well, you know, streets not being cleaned as often and so on. So there's definitely been that. I think a bigger issue, in England at least, is those who pay council tax have seen their council tax go up an enormous amount, largely because of the social care precept, and yet they're seeing simultaneously a worse delivery or a lesser delivery of services than previously. Now, why is that? That's because recipients of social care are a relatively minor part of the population. You know, probably, you know, 4 or 5% of households are in receipt of significant social care delivery. So 100% of households who pay council tax are seeing their council tax going up. Only a relatively small number of people are seeing service delivery, perhaps even still not at the level that they would wish it to be, but nonetheless additional service delivery. And that's a mismatch. No wonder there's a satisfaction issue. I think it's much less about, you know, it's not really an engagement issue, although engagement would help. It would help if people understood that was what was happening, and some authorities, you know, do really good kind of practice in terms of trying to share that bigger picture with their local people. But it is really that I'm paying more, but I'm getting less. No wonder people are less satisfied.
Yeah. And Jonathan, anything you want to add?
Yeah, so we do. So thinking about England, we do polling with Ipsos Mori ahead of local elections. We did polling with Ipsos Mori ahead of local elections in England in May. And, you know, some of the figures that come out of that, only 1 in 4 people trust the UK government to act in the best interests of their local. 40% of people trust local government to act in the interests of the local community. Is that glass half full or glass half empty? We see, you know, people do think that the council is the institution that makes the biggest difference to quality of life in their local area. About half of people think that local services have got worse, but that rises quite steeply when you look at older people. So if you look at 55 to 75-year-olds, 61% of people think that services in their local area have declined in the last 5 years. So, and we know that this is part of an overall picture of declining trust in public institutions. So I think what I would conclude, I mean, you can draw your own conclusions from that, but I think it would be very, quite, I have no reason to think those numbers wouldn't be very similar in Scotland. I think what it shows us is that if we are going to rebuild trust in politics, we have to start from the local, because that's where, you know, it's not great, but that's where trust is highest, and that's where people think the biggest difference to their lives can be made. So I think it is a problem, but it's also an indication that local government has to be part of the solution.
Thanks. You touched upon social care pressures. I think this is an area I was interested to pursue, especially in relation to what that looks like both north and south of the border. In local government, we've seen some pretty major reforms over the course of the last decade to try to address that pressure. For example, integration of health and social care here in Scotland. We're currently, and the Scottish Government's proposing and taking forward a National Care Service Bill. When you speak to councillors, when you speak to officials in councils, the pressure's not easing, it's growing. And, you know, most councils, including my own here in Edinburgh, half of that budget is really from day one for adult social care. And the pressure's just consistently growing and outstripping that demand. So just wondered what your thoughts were with regards to how optimistic you are that that situation is going to improve, or not just create something councils can't resolve. And some of the policy changes we have seen haven't actually helped deliver any real reform which has necessarily improved the situation.
I mean, I guess I would refer back to my earlier answer about place-based, joined-up, preventative approaches. I think the only thing I would add to that is I think we need to be, and we did a piece of work with the University of Birmingham that I can forward to the committee, looking at the Scottish Government's proposals around National Care Service and some of the challenges in that. I think the only cautionary note I would put out is that we talk a lot, quite rightly, about the integration of health and social care. But actually, if the core question, if the core challenge is how do you help people to live happily, healthily, independently for longer, then it's not just about integrating social care with health. It's about integrating social care with housing, with leisure services, with community engagement, with planning, with a whole range of things that are delivered from local government. And I sometimes worry that our focus on health and social care integration, which I think, frankly, is too driven by questions around delayed discharge, which really matter, but actually we should be thinking about how we stop people getting into hospital in the first place. And my worry is that we focus so much on health and social care integration that we lose sight of all the other things that need to be integrated in order to keep people living at home independently and healthily for as long as possible.
I think that's exactly right, Jonathan. I mean, it's just worth kind of unpicking a little bit the demand question. So we've definitely obviously got an ageing population. So there's demand from more people kind of coming into those kind of older age categories. But actually the biggest driver in England, at any rate, of increasing cost in social care is working age provision. We've seen large numbers, at least compared with the past, of young people who survived perhaps difficult childbirth or illness in the young age, who have now made it to adulthood, who perhaps wouldn't have made it to adulthood 20 or 30 years ago, but with large levels of need. Now sometimes they may be able to be supported to have a working life, but in many cases they can't, and those are translating into care packages of £200,000-£250,000 a year. I mean, those are significant amounts of money. On top of that, we've seen a massive increase in children's need in terms of children's social care. So particularly during and following the pandemic, around mental health issues, for example, around special educational needs and so on. So in England, the average is around about 65-70% of for those authorities who provide social care being spent on social care, but in some cases is 80% and above of their revenue budget. So it's a massive issue. I absolutely agree with Jonathan. Is the answer just shoveling more money in or just closing the door? Probably neither of those are acceptable, are they? So we've got to have a different way of kind of addressing these issues, and that has to be a kind of a rounded kind of system level approach that keeps people healthy as much as possible in the first place and helps them live the kind of best life that they possibly can live, including working where that is possible. At the moment, we have a kind of crisis management system where we provide we have queues and gateways that keep people from the door as long as possible. And then when they get through, we provide them with the least possible service that the state can get away with, instead of taking that holistic view that were we joined up around health, social care, housing, leisure, and work, skills support, and so on, would produce a different set of outcomes.
That's a lot to think about there. Thanks very much for that. Thanks, Karina.
Yeah, thanks, Miles. Yes, certainly a lot to think there. That brings us to the end of our questions. I just want to say thanks so much for what's been a very interesting discussion, actually. It's been really insightful and great to get some of your thoughts on what we can do better in Scotland and learning from what's happening in England. And as we previously agreed to take our next two items in private, and that's the last public item, I now close the public part of our meeting.